Oh, right, you know, it's four. Get started with our pre-session. Let's go over the agenda and see. There are going to be some changes that we need to talk about. We'll start off. Welcome, everybody. If everybody could take a minute to silence your cell phone, that would be good. We love to hear what your ringtone sounds like, but it's probably better to not hear it at all. So thank you for doing that, and that will prompt all of us to do it so we don't get embarrassed. Our first matter, Pledge of Allegiance and Invocation. We have public comment. Let me go to the consent agenda. There are a lot of items that we're going to have a discussion of. Normally on the consent agenda items, we do not discuss them. They're kind of summarily passed, but there have been some questions. There's been a request to pull the resolution amending the EDC, Economic Development Coalition bylaws, so we will discuss that. Is there someone here that can present what that's about? Okay. And then the next item that's requested for further discussion is the budget amendment about the Ridgefield Farms. That's half of the budget amendment. The JCPC, as I understand, will stay on the consent agenda unless someone wants that pulled also. But the Ridgefield Farm budget amendment will move to the regular agenda. And we'll put all of these, let's see.
Mr. Chairman, also the special ordinance, it will move.
Okay, I'll get there. Yeah, that's right, all of them. And let's put them at the back of new business, if that's all right with everybody. So that will be the EDC, the Ridgefield Farms, and the special projects amendment. All of those will move for discussion and specific votes. Are there any other matters on the consent agenda that anyone would like to have moved? I think that was a summary of the ones that have been requested. So we will take up each one of those. And we have want someone to do all these. Okay. The good news, we have proclamation of Radon Action Month. Who would like to give that? I think we have Jessica here. Jessica's here to see this. We'll be right with you. We're just going over. Who wants to give this to Ms. Silvers? All right. Thank you, Commissioner. Then we get to good news. We have a resolution accepting auction for sale of surplus property. This is the Mary Benson House. I think Mr. Frew's going to talk about that. All right. Any preliminary questions about that? We have a request from the Coburn.
I would like to make one statement. Those are restricted funds. We inherited that house from Blue Ridge, and it will have to be used for mental health purposes. We'll share that.
Okay. Thank you. Next, we have a request from the Coburn Earth Science Museum, also known as the Asheville Museum of Science. Amos, I see Mr. Newman here, and director here, Court, I think, is here too. So we'll be hearing from them on the request for funding. Next, we have realignment and reallocation of health and human services position. I think Ms. Stone is going to talk to us about that. And then we'll do EDC, Ridgefield, let's see, Ridgefield or Ridge Farm? Ridgeview, not even, none of the above. Ridgeview Farms, okay, and then special project ordinance. We'll hear, okay, and there's the county managers. And you'll have Ms. Pugh talk about the collaboration, I think, so, okay, thank you. Next we go to, skip page 3, that was our problem. So, let's go back. After the good news, we'll actually get into public hearings. The High Wire Brewery incentive has been pulled. It is pulled because there's more information needed on that. That will, I believe, be on the February calendar. Is that right? All righty. So there will be no public hearing on the High Wire incentive request. The next public hearing we have are the amendments to the zoning and maps to adopt zoning in unincorporated areas. There are 9 of those. This is the so-called donut hole zoning that has received some attention. Ms. Trumpy's here to talk about those. Is the Woodfin, I know there was some discussion about Woodfin, is that on or off our agenda at this point? I don't know. There was some discussion that the mayor of Woodfin had made a request on that. We certainly
want to work with the town manager will be here.
I can speak to that.
I don't have my glasses on.
Okay, Jason. Well, why don't you? What is the position? We certainly want to work with our neighboring jurisdictions. What is this?
Yes, sir. Just briefly, and thank you for giving us a chance to speak to this. The town of Woodfin has some concerns over the proposed zoning of the area that's described here in the documents, I believe, as Area 1, the first item to come up before you on the zoning. Our concern is that we do not believe that R3 is appropriate zoning.
Okay, I tell you, Jason, let me summarize. Have you had a chance? Do you feel like it would be helpful to meet with our planning staff and discuss this?
It would be very helpful to discuss it, and the town would appreciate the chance to meet with the planning staff and discuss some of the issues that we have with the proposal prior to a date put before the
Okay, Debbie, do we have any, is that agreeable? Do you want, we can go ahead and have this. It seems like if another jurisdiction has a question about it, it would behoove us to sit down and talk with them before we do this. Do you have an opinion about that, or the manager?
It's at your board's discretion.
Okay, my view would be is if we could benefit by sitting down with the jurisdiction, we should do that. I don't think there's any, I think the only problem is you got the Wild West there right now, which is no zoning whatsoever by Woodfin, Bunk, and anybody else. But I would defer to the town of Woodfin and say, let's sit down and talk to them and see if, hear their concerns before we proceed. What's the pleasure of the board? Okay.
As long as the original property owners are going to have the same opportunity as the jurisdiction, which I think they probably would, to be open.
Okay, so can we make that happen? I think there's kind of a consensus to go ahead and pull this. Could we make sure, of course, the whole idea is the people that live in the area get the same notice, same opportunity. And is anyone here to speak on that today? This is, I guess it's hard to know unless I tell you what it is. Is there someone? Raise your hand. Yes, sir.
It's the area west of Gorman Bridge Road near Crest Mountain.
Okay. Do you, there has been a suggestion by the board to pull this off and bring it probably back up or deal with it the next meeting. Do you have an objection to that, sir? Is that all right with you? I mean, you're here for this, and we don't want to inconvenience people that made an effort to come here.
Yeah, fine.
Okay, and I don't know if. I would certainly like to hear what he has to say, since we've heard from someone else, and I'm wondering if
timing-wise, bringing it back to the next meeting is not
possible. Okay, so when would be the? Okay, so what would be the timeline to return? Okay,
so if we're going to change the recommendation, then that would need to actually go back to the planning board and come through there again. If we just took some time and it came back in its current form, we could just come back whenever we schedule it. But if there's any changes, it kind of starts over, right? So, which would provide, anyone with a chance to provide.
I got one more question in this, too.
Yes, so go ahead. Let's go ahead and work this out. Yeah, go ahead, Commissioner.
The state basically took zoning or extraterritorial jurisdiction away from these areas. Now we have a city coming back asking to change something outside of their territory. Is that legal?
I don't know what they're asking. I just know we hadn't sat down with them. I don't know if they want to yay, nay, or whatever, but...
If I may, sure. The town's intent isn't to tell the county what to do with the property and how to own it, but rather we feel that through consultation, since actually part of the property that's proposed for zoning this evening has actually already been voluntarily annexed into the town of Woodfin, including all of Departure Drive and several acres north of that recently, I think that based on our experience in Fair Cove, where the county recently zoned that donut hole, where we've had some voluntary annexations and more signs of interest in doing that, it would be best to work cooperatively. The town of Woodfin's concern specifically with R3 is that it allows for the development of trailer parks, and that is something the town has had long experience in working with, trying to find better kinds of affordable housing. We simply like to work with county staff, and at this moment, you know, we haven't found the right way to I guess get input, and I think we could find a better solution for the town of Woodfin and Buncombe County and the residents of these areas if we can have some discussion.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah. If we're going to have this much discussion about this, I mean, to me. I'd like to hear from both of these people during the regular meeting, and then we're going to push it out, and let's just say that we're going to push it out in the regular meeting, because there's a lot of discussion that's going on.
I think the discussion is whether to have it or not, and it's not a discussion on merits, although you did get into somewhat of it. I would say probably, my view would be, let's continue this, but if whatever the board, four people on board want to do, is that what would be the pleasure of the board?
I mean, not now, but pushing it off to a later date so we can talk to
it. Okay, is there any? And we can leave it on here. It's the first item on the agenda, so I guess it won't, or it's the second item on the agenda, so it probably won't be. Let's just leave it on. We'll bring it up when we go.
Yeah, have a discussion.
Okay, it's the first thing on. There is a chance that we won't get to this tonight, but we will get to it. We may decide, it's the second item on the agenda, so it will be relatively early. You in particular, sir, we want to make sure your consideration, town manager, we want to accommodate you, we want to be good neighbors with you also. So we're going to leave it on at this point, and we may decide to pull it back, but we'll get started anyway, and we'll have this discussion in open session. This is kind of our preliminary to decide what to hear and what not to hear. So if there was a consensus, we just would go ahead and deal with it now, but I think there's kind of a split about what to do with it, so we'll deal with that the second item on our agenda. Is that all right there, everybody? Okay. Then the... So we have nine different, these are all public hearings. We may or may not hear the first one. That will be a board decision in our open session. And Ms. Trumpy will tell us about all 8 to 9 of them as we go.
Chairman,
yes, ma'am.
What I would propose is that I just go through the maps for all the areas and then just have one public hearing for all the areas. If you want to pull out that one,
I agree with Ms. Belcher. Why don't we do the one in question first and then do them all? If that's all right, we'll do it the way Ms. Trumpy suggests. Okay, that's fine. Thank you. So we will have one public hearing and we will discuss each one, anyone that wants to be heard on any of the ones that are subject of the public hearing, and I'll try to describe them, and Ms. Trumpy will describe each one and any of them. As I understand it, there was no discussion at the board meetings nor within the staff any disagreement about the other ones. Is that right?
That's correct.
And there may be. That's why we have hearings tonight. If someone wants to be heard on it, we certainly want to hear from them. All right. Then we'll go that way. The, then we again have the county manager, and I think you've said Ms. Pugh is going to be talking to you, and this, Mr. Ingraham. Is he here? Ingraham and Pugh? Okay, hopefully they'll be here soon. Okay, and then after that we have board appointments. We have two boards we're going to be looking at tonight. One is the Adult Care Home Community Advisory Board, and the other one is the Nursing Home Community Advisory Board. Then we'll do announcements. Do we need a closed session tonight? All right. Okay, so any questions about how we're going to proceed? I think we've covered all of everything. Okay, then without objection, we will go ahead and get started. So let's go ahead and get our meeting started. January 5, 2016 meeting of the Buncombe County Board of Commissioners, and if you will join me, we will start with the Pledge of Allegiance and invocation. Thank you for another year. We're blessed to be able to end 2016 with all the gifts and talents that you've given each one of us. You've made every single person a unique individual that differs from every other person. During this year, give us wisdom to make good decisions, awareness to be sensitive to the needs of others, clarity to understand and act for the benefit of all people in the county and region, patience and empathy to understand what we really need to do here. We particularly hold out for praise a new addition to our community, Fern Valley Smith, who is Commissioner Joe Belcher's granddaughter, born a couple weeks ago. Thank you for the blessing of new life and the treasures and joys that will give the Belcher family. We're blessed to live in a beautiful and exciting place that presents challenges of growth and development, and help us to deal with that in a way that preserves the beauty and desirability that now draws people from all over the country to live here, to move here, to work here, to retire here. And thank you for the wonderful friends who serve on this commission, all the other committee and board members who guide our policy and decisions, and thank you for letting us see another year to try to do good things that are pleasing to you and our community. Thank you. And I would, as point of personal privilege, I would just ask Granddad Belcher to tell us about his new addition to his family.
Well, we do have a my first granddaughter. She was born 1 month early on December the 15th. She is gorgeous, as you would think I would say, but she's a beautiful child, and her name is Fern. Her middle name is Valley, named after her great-grandmother's middle name, and thank you for mentioning that. Always a joy to brag on your children and grandchildren. Thank you very much.
We're mighty proud. Proud to hear the growing communities. In accordance with the Code of Ethics adopted by the Commission, all county commissioners have a duty to obey the applicable laws regarding official actions, to uphold the integrity and independence of the office, and to avoid impropriety in the exercise of official duties, to faithfully perform the duties of the office, and to conduct the affairs of the governing board in an open and public manner. Is there any item on the agenda, the outcome of which would have a direct, substantial, and readily identifiable financial impact on any board member tonight? Does any board member have any financial interest in any public contract that might come before the commission tonight? Hearing none, I find that each board member has a duty and obligation to vote on every matter that comes before us tonight. Our next order of business is public comment. The time limit for comment to the board is 3 minutes. If your time expires, you may give any additional questions or inquiries along with your name, address, phone number, or email with the county manager. Commissioners are not expected to comment on matters during public comment, and comments should be limited to subjects that are within the jurisdiction of the commission or pertain upon matters to which we may act. Any individual speaking during public comment shall address the entire board. Any polling of board members is inappropriate. Persons addressing the board are expected to observe the decorum of the chamber and to be respectful of everyone in the room, even if their opinion differs from yours. Any person who willfully interrupts, disrupts, or disturbs the session will be asked to leave the meeting, and the board deserves the right to deny public address on any subject previously presented to the commission. We will be having public hearings and discussions on the so-called donut holes. So anyone is here to talk about the zoning map amendments. We're going to have a special meeting, a special part of the meeting that will have public comment during that time. You are welcome to speak at public meeting, but you may want to wait until we pick up your specific property when we have our public meeting on the nine matters that are before us tonight. Is there any member of the public that wished to be heard on public hearing at this point? If you will raise your hand, we'll recognize you.
David, you said public hearing or public comment?
Thank you, Mr. Reichel. Public comment at this point. Yes, sir. We'll do public hearings after we do a resolution and vote on the agenda. Okay, Mr. Yelton. Anyone else like to speak on public comment portion of our... Mr. Rice will be after Mr. Yelton. Anyone else like to speak? Okay, Don, it's all yours.
Don Yelton, Jupiter, North Carolina. Well, hold on to your hat there, David. You don't wear one, but some of us are getting big in the wrong places. I'm telling you, we're expanding too much. And you and I both know what that is. I want to comment you on two things and compliment you. One, I want to thank you for stopping the discussion about the zoning in the pre-meeting and conducting it in the open meeting. Because there has been a tendency by this board to do too much in closed sessions. One, of course, which was come to a consensus. And so I called the Institute of Governance, and I got a bunch of legalese bull crap about the definition of a consensus. So I have a question that I will be emailing to Ms. Green, and she will pass it on to who's necessary. First and foremost, what is the difference in a consensus and a vote in your minds? Secondly, how physically was the consensus determined? Did you look at each other and say, do you agree? I want to know the exact way that the consensus was determined. Because in my mind, and I think in the mind of the residents, you can't get a consensus that you get everybody's opinion. And if you get everybody's opinion, and according to the general statutes, you all should have broke that meeting and come in here and have said, we, in our closed session, have discussed an economic issue and have approved our Assistant County Manager, John Crane, the right to make an offer to a business for economic development, period. And shut up, because you don't have to tell the business and who it is. And then if you've done that, and the press came up and said, who is it, who is it, who is it? Or Don Yelp or Jerry Rison come up and said, who is it? You just say, according to the general statutes, we are not required to give you that information. And then if you did that every time, the people would trust you more than the what they do right now. So that's offered as a positive suggestion. And then in looking through the statutes, I find, I got 38 seconds, 153A40. The Board of Commissioners shall hold, doesn't say they can, or they cannot do it if they want to, shall hold a regular meeting at least once a month, and may hold them more frequently. I checked on the board to find out what your schedule for meetings are for next year, and I find zero. Based upon that general statute, I want from your attorney a legal definition of why you won't have a regular scheduled meeting this 2016. And I want this scheduled. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Young. Mr. Rice?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Hope you all had a great holiday. If you'd been in my house, you'd have had a better one. Mary Benson house that Mrs. County Manager was talking about, the proceeds from that was the sale of the property from Old Blue Ridge, and I brought this up before. I'd like to know where that money is going to be designated specifically. I don't want a broad statement. I'd like to see it broken out into something that I could understand, because the county does need to use it for mental health, substance abuse, and DD services. And I'd say you probably need to do a lot with substance abuse. We have a little more money flexibility on other things. The other concern I have is on Linamar. We've heard in the news recently about Linamar and the big thing they're doing out in Hendersonville and the $14 million that they're appropriating on incentives. My question is, I think we need the county manager to update us on where we're at in Buncombe County with Linamar, and if we're on track of getting what we need out of our incentive money of millions of dollars we put into it, and why, if they have went out there without creating the jobs in Buncombe that they promised, they said by 2020, 400 jobs. So if they're going to go into Henderson County and create something else and get $14 million, why is the media, I haven't even seen the media question that yet. And I certainly think the county commissioners in Buncombe need to be questioning, because if they're just going across the state or county line and creating jobs, and then you tag on that and say, well, look at the jobs they created. No, no. Buncombe County residents are paying a tax incentive here. We want to know if the accountability is being upheld here before they cross the lines and start another incentive in another county. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Mr. Rice. Any other members of the public wish to be heard? All right, the next item of business is the approval of the agenda that we're going to proceed with. Under the consent agenda, the following items have been pulled and moved to discussion at the end of new business. Resolution amending the Economic Development Coalition bylaws, budget amendment on Ridge View Farms, and special projects ordinance that was listed on our original agenda. They will be discussed in detail and specifically voted on. We also have pulled the High Wire Brewing incentive. There is a need for more information on that before we can consider the incentive, and all parties have been notified about that. And so we will move the EDC bylaws, Ridgeview Farm, and special project ordinance to the end of new business. Is there a motion to adopt the agenda with those changes? Been a motion by Commissioner Frost. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Jones. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. And we will follow the agenda as we have discussed. Next item on our agenda is the Good News Proclamation. Is Jessica Silvers here? Jessica, if you can come on up with any guest, and we will talk about Radon Action Month. And Commissioner Jones will do the presentation.
So today we have this proclamation for Radon Action Month. Whereas radon is a colorless, odorless, naturally occurring radioactive gas that threatens the health of our citizens. And whereas according to the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, radon causes more than 20,000 deaths each year, making it the second leading cause of cancer deaths in the United States and the number one cause among non-smokers. And whereas a national health advisory was issued by the U.S. Surgeon General in 2005 because breathing indoor radon over prolonged periods can present a significant health risk. And whereas according to the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, one in 15 homes across the country has an elevated radon level. And whereas in North Carolina, based on data collected by the Radiation Protection Section in the Division of Health Service Regulation, radon is present at elevated levels in about 7% of homes. And whereas indoor elevated levels of radon is a preventable, correctable problem, and testing for radon is simple and inexpensive, ranging from $6 to $30 for do-it-yourself test, and with the cost of repairs by a professional to reduce the radon ranging from radon level ranging from $1,500 to approximately $2,500. And whereas the state's radon program and the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency are encouraging Americans to test their homes for radon, mitigate elevated levels of radon, and build new homes with radon-resistant materials and features. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed by the Board of Commissioners for the County of Buncombe as follows, that January 2016 be proclaimed Radon Action Month in Buncombe County, that this board does hereby urge all citizens and interested groups to promote awareness of the hazards of radon exposure, encourage citizens to test and mitigate their homes for radon levels, and visit www.ncradon.org for additional radon information. That this proclamation be effective upon its adoption the fifth day of January 2016. Chairman Gimp, I move adoption of this proclamation.
All right, it's been a motion. Is there any discussion? I guess we need to technically second it. Second by Commissioner Belcher. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of adopting the resolution as presented by Commissioner Jones, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. The proclamation is adopted by a 7-0 vote. Ms. Silvers, you want to tell us a little bit about what this means to our community and the problems we might have locally?
Sure. So first of all, I'd like to say on behalf of Buncombe County Department of Health and Human Services and the Environmental Health Division of Public Health, I'd like to say thank you for announcing this proclamation for the citizens of Buncombe County. Beginning on Monday at 30 Valley Street at 8 o'clock, we will start disseminating 100 free radon test kits. We are in partnership with the North Carolina Radon Program. Last year, we also made the same partnership, and we were given about 60 test kits. I'm happy to say that within the first week, they were gone, and until as late as December of 2015, we still had citizens calling requesting those free test kits. This year, we have 100 test kits that were made available to us, and we are happy to offer this service to the citizens. I think people find it a great benefit to be able to get the free test kits and get the free resources from the North Carolina Radon Program. So again, I say thank you for your time, your consideration, and your commitment to the health and the protection of the public health of Buncombe County.
Thank you, Ms. Silvers. Any questions or any comments? Thank you. All right, our next matter on the business is a series of public hearings. Amendments to the zoning maps to adopt zoning in unincorporated areas which are not currently zoned. There are 9 separate areas that we're going to be looking at today. They are called the so-called donut hole parcels, where they're surrounded by, Mr. Trump will get into this more, but surrounded by a municipality, a town, or a city. There has been a request in the pre-session to look at the first one and decide if we're going to have a public hearing. We have at least one gentleman that has come here for the public hearing. I think the first thing is let's hear about that. We have the town manager of Woodfin here that has requested, that wanted to be heard, and want to certainly hear from him or any other representative of our cities and towns within Buncombe County. And so, Debbie, tell us a little bit about, this is Debbie Trumpy with our planning board, I mean planning staff. Tell us a little bit about the first one, and then we'll do the rest of them. I think the procedure we had talked about in pre-session that's been adopted is we're going to have one public hearing, but she's going to talk about all the parcels that will be subject in that public hearing. So you can get up and talk on any of them. We have a public hearing, but we're kind of going to do it all at once. We're not going to do nine different ones. So it's the first one we're going to talk about specifically to see if we're going to bring that up, because we had some questions from another government unit. So Debbie, tell us about that.
Would you like to see the maps on that?
Yeah, let's go ahead and see the maps, and let's talk about what's going on here.
And as you had said, these are areas that are currently unzoned, and they're too small to be zoned when we did countywide zoning in 2009. Statutes required that it be at least a square mile in order for the county to zone an area, and these are all less than that. And what we have done is gone back and worked with the planning board and have developed zoning plans for these areas. And this first one is an area that we're proposing to be R3. It's located north of Ben Lippin Road and west of Gorman Bridge Road. It includes Desperate Lane, Race Pathway, Impala Trail, View Street, Lorenz Lane, Shelby Road, Antebellum Drive, Renee Road, South Old Reimer Drive, Old Reimer Drive, Begonia Gardens, Sierra Drive, and Smith Road. And what we're proposing, and it's the area that was outlined in blue and then shown sort of this beige color, to be R3. The area consists of both larger and smaller residential lots with a mix of stick-built and manufactured housing, and also contains several manufactured home parks. The area is adjacent to areas currently zoned residential R3 by Buncombe County to the east and south, and that's the green area. During public comment at the planning board meeting that was heard November the 16th, three people asked questions about annexation, previous development, and benefits that zoning could offer. The planning board found that the proposed R3 zoning would be consistent with the land use plan, reasonable, and in the public interest, and voted in a unanimous vote to recommend the R3 zoning on the area.
All righty. You know, I'm kind of thinking maybe the fastest way to do, or the most efficient way to do this would be to have a public hearing on this particular one, since we have at least two people here. The board, if that's all right, I think I might change it. Let's go ahead and do that, unless the board disagrees. Let's go ahead and do that, and then we can decide whether we take it up or whether we defer and do later. Is that all right with the board? I think that might be the best way. When everybody gets their say, we have two people here that have, at least two that have interest in this. And so I think I misstated it. The donut hole is it's surrounded by county and or city, and for whatever reason the city or county did not decide to annex or zone it themselves. We couldn't do it because the law said we couldn't do it because of the size of it, and now the law has been changed and we can go back and do it. So we basically have areas that have no zoning, kind of a no man's land, so to speak, where there's no municipal nor county zoning. Is that?
Well, in this case, it is adjacent to county zoning. When we adopted countywide zoning, though, it was adjacent to Asheville's ETJ.
Okay.
So that's how county zoning got there, is when we were zoning the ETJ area. We had such a short time period to get that done that we just did the ETJ area, knowing that we would come back and get these, what had been donut holes, did those all together.
Okay, ETJ, go ahead and explain that real quick.
That was the extraterritorial jurisdiction, which the city of Asheville and Weaverville had exercised up to a mile outside their limits, they'd exercise their own development regulations, and by the statutory authority to do that was taken away from Asheville and Weaverville in the past couple years. And so the county went in and zoned the most appropriate zoning designation that we had to match what they already had in that municipal zoning.
Okay.
In that,
go ahead.
Where is Crest Mountain?
Crest Mountain is west and north.
How far is it from the area we're talking about?
I think it's adjacent.
So it's the white area to the left as we're looking at the map?
Yes.
And
in the town of Milton.
Above the map, right? That's Crest Mountain. Okay.
I'm not sure how far on the northern end it goes.
Okay.
How much is this total partial was in the Woodfin jurisdiction versus the Asheville jurisdiction?
Well, the area that we're proposing to zone is not in Woodfin's jurisdiction.
Actually, just by way of correction, and Ms. Trumpy wouldn't have this because it hasn't been recorded yet due to...
Jason is the town manager. I'm going to go ahead and ask you to come up because I want the public to hear. You know, we're doing this a little bit different than we will the rest of the public hearings because... We definitely want to defer and respect the other government entities within our jurisdiction.
Due to staff shortages, unfortunately, I am the sole administrative member of the administrative staff of Woodfin at this moment due to illnesses and leaves of absences and people taking positions elsewhere. So we are behind on recording some, but portions of the property that are being described have been voluntarily annexed into the town of Woodfin. I would say significant acreage, including Desperate Lane, which was a former trailer park purchased by Reese Lasher, the developer of Crest Mountain, and that has been brought in, and then portions owned by Crest Mountain Gated Communities that are to the north portion of this property have also been annexed into the town of Woodfin voluntarily. And in the last couple of months. So some of it is in Woodfin presently and has been zoned by the town of Woodfin. So I don't know if, I just wanted to make that clarification, and I'd be more than happy to let Ms. Trumpy finish her presentation and then continue the town's comments.
Okay, stay close, sit right down there. Uh-huh. Ask some more questions.
Question?
Go ahead.
This, okay. The white that we've seen up there, mm-hmm. Is the town manager saying that part of that has been voluntarily annexed?
What he's saying is part of what we're proposing to zone has been voluntarily annexed, and I believe there are some recording issues to where it's not necessarily a complete annexation at this point.
So those landowners have agreed to that?
It would have had to have been a voluntary annexation.
Thank you.
And certainly
we have the authority to change what they've done in, I mean, would Woodfin...
My understanding is it's not been all properly recorded yet, so it's not actually annexed at this point.
I move that we remove this piece of property from the hearing. And
I'll second that.
Okay. Yes, sir, Mr. Farnley. There's been a motion. I'll take it as a motion to table this to a later date. Would that be appropriate, Ms. Pettoy?
Well, I mean, I want to make sure that, I mean, it needs to be revised, I think. Mm-hmm. You know, so I don't know that it's, I think I'm asking it to go back and get,
okay.
And let the, you know, hopefully it'll get recorded soon. And then we can, the planning board can look at it anew, just as one piece. And make the decision on the newly defined piece of property, and then we will have a conversation about that piece of property. So I don't know that mine's a table.
No, I don't think it is. I think it's a motion to refer back to the planning.
And that was the motion that I seconded.
Okay, so there's a motion to refer this matter back to the planning board. Is that right? Okay. Discussion, Mr. Farr.
Still in the discussion, we had two people in the room. We have another gentleman to speak. We should not even thought about doing this. But the other thing is, does Woodfin actually have the property zoned now?
Sir, we have had the zoning hearing on that concurrent with the annexation hearing. It is zoned under our ordinance as Mountain Village, which is concurrent with what the Crest Mountain community is currently zoned, which is decidedly different from the county's part of it. Our sections of it. And so that's our position.
And the only other thing is the owner of the property that adjoins this. Where are they at in this issue?
The owners that approached us for voluntary annexation did so.
Not those.
I'm sorry, sir.
The ones that you're basically, this property that basically is adjoining, not the ones that you're talking about.
Well, I'm talking about two separate issues. And just to be clear, the town has conducted the annexation hearings for sections of the area that the county is considering zoning and has carried those out. As Ms. Trumpy points out, those maps have not been officially recorded with the Register of Deeds, but it is our position that they are valid, legal, binding annexation hearings, and that the recording will take place imminently to finalize that. The other issue that the town of Woodfin has is that we would like to have discussions at least about the future of some of those areas, because we do see a drift towards additional voluntary annexation of those areas into the town. And as we've seen in the Bear Cove Donut Hole, which is entirely surrounded by the town of Woodfin, which the town of Woodfin has invested considerable effort in the development of Reynolds Mountain, Versant, Ventana, Serenity, and surrounding developments. We have some concerns about the R3 designation that was placed in there, because, again, that area will never be anywhere other than in the town of Woodfin or in Buncombe County. It's completely surrounded by the town. So it can never be annexed voluntarily or otherwise by any other municipality. And with that investment, some of our concern is that the R3 designation invites a level of development that diminishes that investment around it. And so we do have some concerns and would like to speak to the planning board. And that was something that we'd not become aware of until we read it in the newspaper. So what we're asking for simply is, again, a chance to express our views prior to, you know, the finalization of a recommendation. And that's our request.
All right, sir. Any other questions, Mr. Young, before he sits? Sir, I'm going to go ahead and recognize you if you'd like to be heard on the third row that had an interest in this. If you would like to be heard, right now there's a motion to put this, to send this back to the planning board because of the issues you've heard from the town of Woodfin, the concerns from the town manager, and we're glad to hear from you. You've made a point to be here, so I'll recognize you if you'd like to be speak at this point. If not, you certainly don't have to. It's looking like it may go off to another time.
Yeah, I just had questions about that were answered at the last meeting when I was out of town.
Come on up.
Okay, come on up. We'll go ahead, because you know, you made an effort to be here. We certainly, I didn't really call. I've kind of gone back and forth on public hearing. The big thing is we hear from you. So go ahead, sir. You'll give your name and where you live.
My name is Jameson Town, and I live on Renee Road.
And yes, sir.
The questions I would have asked at the last meeting are, is there any increased taxes or fees that are going to come with this annexation? And is there any increase or reduction in services that would impact me as a homeowner?
All right, sir. We'll take that up. Thank you.
So we're not proposing any annexations at this board. There's some voluntary annexations.
I misspoke. I mean, the rezoning.
Is it okay? Right.
What effect that would have on?
So it's not but unlike the annexation, which would have a tax effect and a service level effect. The zoning is just establishes different development regulations, but shouldn't affect the tax rate, at least not directly.
All right, thank you. Okay, Ms. Trump, you give me, or Mr. Young, do you have anything to add to, I think we should answer his questions before we take this matter up by motion by Commissioner Jones. Anything you want to add to what Commissioner Lee covered? Okay. All right, well, we have a motion before us to refer this back to the Planning Board for further consideration, made by Commissioner Jones, second by Commissioner Frost. Is there any further discussion among the board?
I would just like to say that in light of the new information that some of the areas that we are considering rezoning are actually are on their way to being part of becoming part of Woodfin, being annexed by Woodfin, I am in support of sending this back to Planning Board so we can, you know, deal with Buncombe County zoning issues and not get into a big ball of spaghetti on the rest.
All right. Thank you, Commissioner. Any other comments?
I've got a comment. I just appreciate the opportunity, the clarification to, for Woodfin to have their discussion and the gentleman to have his. And, you know, to be able to do that, I think it's good for the public and good for this board. And I am also going to support the motion.
All right. Thank you, Commissioner. Any other comments? Sounds like the donut hole got partially filled in while time we started and it got to this point. That's why we have public hearings. That's why we appreciate our media bringing things to everybody's attention. Any further comments?
And so the assumption is that the lands that are being voluntarily annexed will be pulled out, and then the remaining donut hole properties will come back. Is that the anticipation of the guidance we're sending on this?
I would think so, yes, sir.
And if I could, by way of clarification, the town of Woodfin's concern primarily what brought me out here, because our annexation, once finalized, would then the zoning would supersede any previous zoning. Our real concern, again, is hoping to be part of the discussion about at least having a voice in some of those discussions about whether R3 is the appropriate designation for that. Planning is, of course, not just about what's on the ground now, but about the future and the direction. We would like a chance to revisit what is proposed there. I know that that just speaking on behalf of the Board of Aldermen for the town, there were some concerns, again, referencing R3 within the Baird Cove subdivision. And hopefully we can bridge some of the communication. And again, with a limited staff, we're sometimes well behind the curve, and I apologize for that. But we would hope to address the Planning and Zoning Board about the R3 designation, since we do see room for growth and believe that there's a better affordable solution, a better affordable housing solution for Buncombe County than more trailer parks. We think there's a better way to go, and we would like to be part of finding that solution.
All right.
Thank you.
Well, I just watch the, I guess they'll be posting it just like normal, and they'll have the opportunity to speak just like any of the other landowners as far as when it goes back. So they'll have their opportunity to do that at that time with the Planning Board, right? John, thank you.
I guess the only downside here is it will be unzoned for a period of time, as Woodfin works through their process, and the part that you don't annex or zone will be still unzoned by anybody.
And I guess, you know, I just, the only comment I would have on this is first, we are sending this back. Sometimes I think, you know, the Planning Board or other bodies might kind of wonder if there's some specific meaning implied in that. So. I mean, I certainly do want Woodfin, as the neighboring, you know, municipality, to have input on this, since other parts of this property will probably be part of Woodfin in the future, and if not, they're at least right next door. But there are obviously a lot of different perspectives on this, and I can maybe one question, Ms. Trumpy, is that if it does come back, and obviously there's the issues with you know, spot zoning and things like that in certain circumstances, but with a property of this size, it doesn't necessarily have to all be one zoning designation. Is that right? I mean, there could be a mixture of different zoning classifications in a piece of property that large, because
that's
I appreciate the concern that's raised, but there I could also see if we went with something different, some of the same issues we wrestled with a couple of weeks ago about you know, putting land under classification where there's a lot of uses that are now non-compliant with a new zoning classification could be you know, present if we chose a different zoning classification for the whole area. So I guess I'm just saying I don't want us to send a signal that we're prejudicing how that recommendation might come back to us. We want everyone to be heard, but it was a unanimous recommendation that came to us, so I don't want to discount the thought that's been put into this today as well.
I want to piggyback on that. You know, I also don't want the planning board to think that we did not agree with their assessment of that property in light of what was under that property, because I would have, you know, voted for it. But in light of the information we found, we wanted to go back so that they can have their say. That's not sending a signal back that we want it in any particular way at all.
We were just unaware that Woodfin had voluntarily annexed some of the part of the parcel that's in question.
All right, good. Any other discussion or comments? All right, we have a motion on the table. The motion is to refer the first proposed zoning R3 back to the planning board for further consideration and discussion with Woodfin. This is without prejudice to any outcome, but just to send it back to get some more feedback and information and discussion with our neighboring jurisdiction, the town of Woodfin. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Then that will be the action. Everyone will be re-notified. Sir, if you wish to come back and have any questions about it, we'll certainly, we didn't lose anything tonight except for just getting more information. So thank you. Okay, now we'll go back to Plan A, which was to talk about eight different, and thank you, Mr. Young. It's always good to see town manager. Town managers, we like to work with our municipalities, and thank you for coming and expressing your opinion, because we appreciate Woodfin and all the good things you do for our mutual constituents there. Ms. Trumpy, let's hear about the 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. Donut holes, some probably have not been filled in, unlike the first one, so we'll kind of go from there.
If we could go back to the PowerPoint, please. All of these were heard by the planning board at their November 16th meeting, and they held separate public hearings for each one of these, so I'll go over what happened at each one of those hearings. But as you stated, this will just be one public hearing for all the rest of these areas.
Okay, so as she goes through, just make sure everybody's on the same page. We will hear from anyone that's interested in any one of these eight parcels. We're going to do this all at the same time. I believe we vote each individual one, we vote as a group.
You could vote them as a group. If you wanted to pull out any of the other areas to have a separate vote, that's certainly your prerogative, but if you wish to vote the same on all of them, I would ask that you have a vote on consistency with the land use plan, and then a separate vote on approval or denial.
I think we'll do a separate vote on each one. That'd feel a little better. Wouldn't that be a little cleaner? Okay. Go ahead.
Okay. This area is proposed to be zoned R2, outlined in blue there. And it's two parcels, 65 Lookout Road and 77 Lookout Road. Both lots are residential. One lot contains apartments, and the other lot contains a single-family site-built home. The area is adjacent to the city of Asheville in the UNCA campus on the northeast and south, and adjacent to the town of Woodfin to the west and north. At the planning board hearing, no one spoke during public comment. We're proposing it to be R2, completely surrounded by Asheville and Woodfin. The next area, we've got two separate zoning proposals on this map. The first one is the two areas that are on the eastern side, excluding the one westernmost area. And those are proposed to be zoned R3. And that's 60 Hornot Circle, a portion of 23 Jet Court, and a portion of 264 Richmond Hill Drive. The area consists of small to moderately sized lots on which single-family homes and adult care home are located. The property is adjacent to property zoned residential district R3 by Buncombe County, which is shown in green there, and RM6 by the city of Asheville. At the public hearing, no one spoke during public comment. And then back to the westernmost parcel on this map. That is proposed to be PS Public Service. It is 280 Richmond Hill Drive. The area consists of one lot zoned by the city of Asheville and is part of Richmond Hill Park. The property is adjacent to property zoned residential district R3 by Buncombe County and INST and RM6 by the city of Asheville, and is also adjacent to property within the town of Woodfin. Again, no one spoke during public comment in the planning board hearing. And this next area is proposed to be zoned CS. Outlined in blue there is 800 Riverside Drive and a portion of tax lot pin 96397615 94, which is located just to the south of 800 Riverside Drive. This area is an existing landscaping company and the outdoor seating area for the adjacent Bywater Bar. Property to the north, east, and south is commercially zoned and located within the town of Asheville, and the property is bordered by the French Broad River to the west. Again, there was no public comment during the planning board hearing. Our next area is proposed to be R3, and it is tax lot pin 96282608 39, located to the north of 433 Deverview Road and a portion of 419 Deverview Road. The area consists of a 0.35 acre vacant lot and a portion of a lot owned by Sunrise Baptist Church. The property is adjacent to property zoned RM8 by the city of Asheville and is in close proximity to property along Deverview Road zoned residential district R3 by Buncombe County. So shown in green there is the R3 zoning by Buncombe County. Again, there was no public comment at the public hearing.
The question, does that allows for
churches? It does. This next area, which is proposed to be zoned R1, is tax lot 96456374 76, and it's located east of 34 Deaver Haven Lane and a portion of tax lot pin 96456229 63, located behind 331 Red Fox Circle. The area consists of a 3.01 acre lot that is used as a park by the surrounding neighborhood and owned by the Brayside Property Owners Association. A very small portion of a vacant tract owned by the Biltmore Park and a small portion of a vacant tract owned by Biltmore Park Association. The subject property is surrounded by single-family residences on moderately and larger sized lots. Properties to the south, east, and north are within the city of Asheville and are zoned RS2. Properties to the west are zoned single-family residential district R1 by Buncombe County, and those are shown in yellow and were previously part of Asheville's ETJ. Again, no one spoke during public comment at the planning board public hearing. Our next area is proposed to be zoned CS, and it's a portion of 25 Hereford Way. The area consists of an existing portion of unzoned property that is utilized as a stormwater basin for the Biltmore Town Square mixed-use development. Contiguous property to the north is vacant and zoned CS commercial service by Buncombe County, as the area is shown in red. Surrounding property to the east, south, and west is primarily developed and located within the city of Asheville. At the planning board hearing, no one spoke in public comment. This is our last area and is proposed to be zoned PS. It is 590 Brevard Road. The area consists of an existing church and associated cemetery. Property to the south is part of Biltmore Estate and zoned Conference Center Resort District. That's the pinkish color. To the east and north is the WNC Farmers Market, which is zoned PS Public Service, and that's the purple area. Property to the west is a mix of uses, including the post office, gas station, and convenience strip center. Those are all located in the city of Asheville and are separated from this by Brevard Road. Again, no one spoke during public comment at the planning board hearing.
Question, Ms. Trumpy. Churches are allowed under this also?
We permit churches in all of our zoning districts.
Thank you.
For each of these areas, the proposed zoning is consistent with the land use plan for reasons outlined in the staff analysis, and the planning department recommends approval. The planning board found in each of the public hearings that the proposed zoning was consistent with the land use plan, reasonable and in the public interest as outlined in the planning board resolution, and recommended approval in unanimous votes. I'd be happy to answer any questions you have for me right now.
Any questions for Ms. Trumpy about any of these parcels?
I have one question, but I think you answered it while you were. None of the landowners came and objected to these at the meetings, correct?
That's correct. During the public hearings, there was no one commented for or against any of these.
Thank you.
Any other questions before we start the public hearing on all eight of these? All right. Let's start the public hearing. I see 526. Does any member of the public wish to be heard in any of these parcels, except for the first one? We've already dealt with that one. Anybody wish to be heard? Mr. Rice? Anyone else besides Mr. Rice wish to be heard?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I'm not a lawyer, and we probably have to get out of this room and find one to answer this question, but the other situation here in Woodfin, I'm just wondering if there's something that might be arrived in these other districts, because Woodfin is a town and a municipality that knows the legalities of some things and others. So I'm just wondering if they've been a real search here done on the question of, is it the possibility of this same thing in some of these other districts that's happened in Woodfin, and they just don't know about it. But if you don't have people coming out and knowledgeable of what's going on, you know, they can have wool pulled over their eye pretty quick. And I'm just concerned because a lot of people in the community don't know. Even though they might get this letter in their hand, they might not know. Woodfin, yes, they're coming out and saying it because they got lawyers and they got people that's knowledgeable about what's going on. And it just don't make sense to me that somebody ain't out here talking about it, about these other districts that's being put in here. So I think that's a question that needs to be asked.
Thank you, Mr. Ross. Any other members of the public wish to be heard on any of these eight parcels that we have heard described by Ms. Trumpy? Seeing none, I'll declare the public hearing closed at 5:30. Ms. Trumpy suggested we vote on jointly. I kind of would feel a little more comfortable voting each one separately if the board would entertain. Be a little repetitive, but I think the people that have this property probably deserve a specific vote. So I would entertain a motion to act on the parcels 2 through 9.
I'll make a motion to approve based on the planning board's or the staff's suggestion because it's consistent with the land use.
And reasonable in the public interest?
Yes.
Okay. Been a motion on parcel 2. Is there a second? Been seconded by Commissioner Fryer. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of approving the recommendation of parcel 2, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. 7-0. Parcel 3. I make a motion that the request be granted is consistent with the comprehensive land use plan, reasonable in the public interest. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Frost. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor of parcel 3, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That it is adopted. Parcel 4.
I move to approve that it is reasonable, consistent, and in the public interest that this be approved.
It's been a motion by Commissioner Jones. Second. Second by Commissioner DeBrule. Any further discussion?
I know we're taking these piece by piece, but generally, just a general statement about all of these. It is important to me to be fair and consistent, and I just want to make a point of saying that there. We haven't heard from any property owners that there's any opposition to this. Property owners' opinions are important.
Okay. Any other discussion of parcel 3? Or 4, excuse me. Parcel 4. Good catch. Okay, I'll call the question on parcel 4. All those in favor of approving the recommendation amendment, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Parcel 5.
Make a motion that is request is consistent with the county comprehensive land use plan and reasonable in the public interest.
Commissioner Belcher's made a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Jones. Any further discussion? All those in favor of parcel 5, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Parcel 6.
Move approval of this rezoning that it is consistent, reasonable, and in the public interest.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Jones, second by Commissioner Frost. Any further discussion? All those in favor of parcel 6 adoption, say aye.
Aye.
Parcel 7.
Move approval of this rezoning that it is consistent, reasonable, and in the public interest.
Okay. Motion by Commissioner Jones, second by Commissioner DeBrule. Any further discussion? All those in favor of parcel 7, say aye.
Aye.
Parcel 8. Move that the parcel be amendment be adopted, consistent with the county land use plan, reasonable in the public interest. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Frost. Any further discussion? All those in favor of parcel 8 adoption, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Number 9.
Move approval of this rezoning that is consistent with land use plan and reasonable and in the public interest.
Second. Motion by Commissioner Jones, second by Commissioner Fryer. Is there any discussion of parcel 9? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Then each of these has been adopted by 7-0 vote. Thank you very much. Thank you, Ms. Trumpy. Next, we have county manager report. We'll recognize Mandy Stone, the assistant county manager, and
Chairman and Commissioners, we wanted to provide an update tonight on our work toward a comprehensive behavioral health urgent care center. And in part, it seemed very fitting to do it here because it was the direction of this Board of Commissioners that asked staff to look at areas where we are investing large support in terms of county resources and our safety net, and could we improve the coordination of those and serve citizens better and use public dollars more efficiently. We want to provide that update today. Who's with us today is Jenny Pugh, who's the Senior Director of Community Collaboration for Smoky Mountain, Brian Ingram, who is their CEO, and Gordon Simmons and Sandy Fuchs from RHA, who are actually the service provider. They're our comprehensive adult service provider. Sandy is the clinical director and Gordon is their CEO, and I will turn it over to them.
Thank you very much for being here and talking to us tonight. It's very important to us. Thank you.
Good evening. It is nice to be with you. I am Jen Pugh. I'm with Smoky Mountain. Smoky Mountain is your local management entity and managed care organization for the provision of behavioral health services, not only in Buncombe County, but in the 23 westernmost counties in North Carolina. So we're very involved in your county and surrounding counties in the area of behavioral health. We are going to report to you today briefly on a very important project here in Buncombe County. I'm really grateful to be here with the people in this front row. These are just a few, but very important people of a visionary group who met here really less than 18 months ago in this very building to suggest that we had to take decisive action. We had to create a plan that would be something very new, very different for this area. So here we are, just a short time later, to let you know where we are with this project. So there are very important stakeholders in the project. It's important that you know about them. You are one of those stakeholders and major partners. So it is Smoky Mountain, RHA Health Services, Family Preservation Services, Mission Health, Buncombe County Health and Human Services, ABCCM, NAMI, which is the National Alliance on Mental Illness, which has been in your community for a very long time. And at the bottom, the Department of Health and Human Services, North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services, Crisis Solutions Initiative, which provided a lot of the support and effort in this project. So let me just try to set the stage for you a little bit. These three bullets kind of tell us what our major problems are. We have behavioral health crisis at an all-time high in Western North Carolina, which is resulting in many, many people going to emergency departments for their care, and that is not a good idea for many reasons. I see some of you already shaking your heads. You understand this. And another driver in all of this is that we find ourselves with insufficient inpatient treatment capacity. Now, those are just simple bullets to give you an idea. I want you to know, though, this is not just a Buncombe County problem. This is not just a North Carolina problem. This is a national problem. One statement from Robert Glover indicates that our states have cut $5 billion in mental health services between 2009 to 2012. And that the country at the same time has eliminated more than 4,500 psychiatric hospital beds, treatment beds for people. So this is part of what is driving this crisis. Tom Insel from National Institute of Mental Health says, the way we pay for mental health today is the most expensive way possible. We don't provide support early, so we end up paying for lifelong support, and we end up paying very expensive services. And I can tell from Andy's comments that you already knew that. This is a very interesting and kind of strong statement from Tim Murphy in Pennsylvania. We have replaced the hospital bed with the jail cell, the homeless shelter, and the coffin. And while this may seem rather dramatic, I think most of you who hear from constituents and neighbors and others know that this is actually a true statement. So those statements kind of bring us back to what it is that we are doing. And Smoky has this responsibility not just for Buncombe, but for the 23 counties in the West. So we're very intent on developing a comprehensive care center model across our regions, which means that people could receive same-day access to crisis services. And this model would be scaled across the regions. We want very much to grow the capacity and the response of mobile crisis teams, and we want to build local capacity for prevention, early intervention, recovery-oriented systems of care, and community resilience model. And while that may just sound like mumbo-jumbo, what it means is helping people to get on a path to recovery, helping people to live healthier lives for the long term, and helping them to access services early rather than waiting till they're in the middle of a full-blown crisis and end up either in the emergency department or the jail. So that's our long-term vision. So what does that mean for you in Buncombe County? It means you are first, and you will probably be the largest. So what is happening at 356 Biltmore Avenue, which you all have known for a long time, kind of as the home of behavioral health in your county, we are creating C3 at 356. And why is it C3 at 356? The three C's are Comprehensive Care Center. 356 is the address on Biltmore Avenue. What we're trying to figure out is how to communicate very quickly and directly with people who need the service. We understand that the word on the streets here is go to 356. Was what people always knew. For a long time, you probably know, there hasn't been service delivery at 356 Biltmore. There has been your local management entity. This was Smokey's largest office. We are not there any longer. We're creating something new that's more responsive to your citizens. So what are we creating co-located at this one address under one roof with a great big front door for people of all ages with all disabilities? We are creating a service array that will hopefully meet all of their needs. Behavioral health urgent care, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, for all ages and all disabilities. This doesn't exist anywhere in Western North Carolina at this moment. This is something very big, very new. Facility-based crisis services for children and for adults. You already have this service existing at Neil Dobbins Center, which will ultimately move over to this facility, but we're going to have this service for children. This does not exist anywhere in Western North Carolina now. Mobile crisis management services, which have existed but are growing and becoming more robust, and the dispatch location will be at 356. Outpatient behavioral health services, same-day access to care, peer-led living room, which is a brand new model, which we could talk to you about for hours, but we won't. We'd love to, on another time, explain to you what that is. NAMI will stay in that location, is staying in that location to offer family support, education, resources, and ABCCM community pharmacy. And this piece is really critically important. We've done a lot of research about why it is that somehow our system fails people. And one of the major things we know is that once people do connect with service, they often end up with a prescription in their hand that never gets filled, and they never start taking their medication. They end up back in crisis, back up in the emergency department. Having this all under one roof, having a pharmacy right there so that a person can walk from their clinician's and their physician's office across the hall to a pharmacy and have their prescription filled and get their pharmacy education right there is going to, we think, take us a long way to really creating a good system of care for people. So this is a fancy diagram that talks about crisis continuum. I won't make you look at all of it now, but I did put it in your packet so you can study it at home. This is a nationally known model for continuum of care for crisis services. And what we did with this model was we just put in each quadrant every service that is available or will be available at this new comprehensive care center. So people ask usually at this point, how in the world do you think you're going to do all this? And so we just like to stop for a moment and say, we're going to do it really carefully and very planfully in a very organized way. So this slide simply shows you our landing page or our overview for our project manager to get all of this done. And just suffice to say that there are many different people working on this project, more than just those major stakeholders that I outlined for you earlier. Over 14 different organizations are represented on these work groups, and there is now a work plan that is more than 50 pages long with more than 180 discrete tasks on it in order to get all of this work done. And for most of those work groups, they are more than 90%, some are 100% complete, and there is no work group that is not now 80% complete. So we're moving very quickly towards our goal. So here's a quick progress update. The first thing we had to do was to secure funding for construction and startup, and you all were a part of that. Buncombe County has money in this project. So does Mission Health, so does Smoky Mountain. Most importantly, that Crisis Solutions Initiative, which is an initiative of the governor. They let out four opportunities for projects like this. There was competition for that grant money. We did compete. We did submit our proposal in December of last year, and we received notice on January 13th of last year that we were awarded the funding. So that's a big piece of how we're able to do this. Our project management plan is in process, nearing completion. The clinical program design is almost complete. RHA Outpatient Services, once Smoky Mountain moved out of that building in March, we worked very hard to get RHA Outpatient Services moved in with a lot of support from the county. The building was really renovated nicely and made ready for this new service. And on July 1st, the whole array of outpatient services opened there at C3. So that was the first phase of implementation. Soon after that, the community pharmacy opened in October. NAMI stayed there on site, so we have a really full complement of outpatient services now. The peer living room and urgent care construction began and will be complete this month. Furniture has been ordered. That space will be available very, very soon for that second phase of implementation. And we have started construction on the addition that is required to have enough square footage to meet the requirements for facility-based crisis for the New Orleans Center to move over. So that's just an overview of where we are now. I like to show this slide because I want people to understand that while all this planning was going on, we were still working very hard on our major goals to divert people in crisis away from emergency departments, to help them get quick access to the care they need in community-based services. So this is a very simple slide that gives a little perspective of the blue line being all the people who go to the Mission ED, a very high number. That number is ranging between 400 and 500 every month from January of 2014 through the last data point, which is September of 15. So that number is not going down yet, as we would hope, but the good news is the red line. That red line represents all of the diversions or all of the people who went somewhere else, including their own home and having mobile crisis come to them. But all of the people whose crisis needs were met outside of the ED. And you can see that once we started working very hard on this, it didn't take us long to eclipse the ED numbers and stay above those numbers. The February dip has to do with some very cold weather and some bed unavailability at Neil Dobbins last winter. But other than that, the trend line looks very positive. So this is the project overview timeline. The major points on this are indicated by the stars, and I've covered most of those. I'd like for you to look at that third star, which says February, the behavioral health urgent care and peer living room should at least be open as a soft start by that time, and in the spring we'll be open in full swing for those services. So this new opportunity for people to have a 24/7 option of a place to go other than the emergency department will be a reality this spring. When we get to early summer, that is when we will expect to have the building complete for facility-based crisis. And the really great news about this, having all of these services in one location is great, but by doing this, we opened up the space at Neil Dobbins and created the opportunity to open the child facility-based crisis there. So that will come on probably later summer, early fall. So that is your implementation timeline. Just one more sign, one more empirical piece of data to show you things are working. This is a simple bar graph that shows you 2014 numbers against 2015 numbers. This is only for RHA. This one walk-in setting, which is now at C3 356. So you can see that the numbers started climbing pretty rapidly once they moved to the C3 location, which is known in the community, and there's a lot of just word-of-mouth information. So they went from 220 people in July to 264 to 342, dropped a little bit in October, but came back up. I don't have the last two data points, but I do know them. Back up over 300 just this month in December. So you can see that this is a new culture that we're trying to build in this county, that people have an option to access services quickly and in a welcoming way that feels safe to them, feels good to them, helps them have a choice other than being in the emergency department or continuing to stay in crisis. So this is signage for the building. That some of that signage has gone up. This is the way we're going to let people know where we are on Biltmore Avenue. This is the lobby in the building, and I want you just to spend a few seconds looking at this lobby, because the goal was to create a space that felt like any of us would want to walk into to receive our health care, whether that be physical health or behavioral health. And I think with the support of Buncombe County, we have made that happen. This facility, and I'm hoping you all will take the opportunity to visit when we have open houses, it is really a beautiful, welcoming space and feels really good to the people coming in there. And this is just the outside of the facility and shows you an area that can be accessed for the lower floor, which will be the peer living room, the 24/7 urgent care, and then ultimately facility-based crisis. So I promised Mandy I would not talk a very, very long time, but I would try to give you as much information as I could very quickly to give you a sense of what is going on at C3356, and really to come here and say thank you so much for recognizing the need, for having the belief that we could do this, and trusting this great partnership to work together. Thank you so much.
Great, thank you, Ms. Pugh. Any questions from Ms. Pugh about what we're doing? It sounds like a wonderful program, getting you on the same page under the same roof.
I just have a comment. One, it's wonderful to see you.
Commissioner Frost.
But it's not really a question, it's just a comment. The most vulnerable people in our community can walk in and be treated like everybody else. And, you know, we do so many things that are, not to take away from something, but this has a tangible touching effect on the people who don't think anybody cares about them. So I thank everybody for all the work.
I really appreciate your recognition of that. Your statements are absolutely on point. Thank you.
In just these months, the data that you've got about the increases is just mind-boggling. You know, particularly that lab, those bar graphs of the walk-in stuff. That's incredible.
I appreciate your recognition of that. And I have to say, I'm a little bit of a data wonk. Sandy and Brian are very indulgent of my need to always be tracking the data. And I always have to ask about what's behind the data, because I want to know not just how many people are showing up, but who are they and why are they showing up? And so I ask lots of questions. And one of the greatest things about this is we know the peak hours that people show up at the emergency departments, and it's typically afternoon and runs into early evening. And so when we saw this really dramatic increase at C3, one of the first things I said is, tell me the time of day they're coming. And really, some people said, not only will we tell you, but stand here and watch it. So beginning at about 8:30 in the morning, people begin to arrive on foot, on public transportation, in cars with friends or family. And they're showing up at 8:30, 9, 9:30. My first thought about this is these are people who really are hungry for treatment, hungry for care, hungry to be on a path for recovery. These are people who got out of bed early to be first in line. And I just think that's just a really a critical thing to understand about this.
Just a quick question. When you say there's 300 people or 400 people, is that 300 different people or is...
Yes, and let me just say, because I do love the data, we were in a meeting this morning looking at our most current data, and it's sobering because in the month of December, when we total up everybody in this county, unduplicated numbers of people who showed up for service in December. This includes the emergency department, Neil Dobbin, family preservation, RHA's walk-in, RHA's mobile crisis. The last number I totaled, and we'll get more numbers, but we're at 998 people who came in for service in your county in December. That's a lot. And some of those people are not entirely new to the system, but they kind of got lost or they fell out and they're coming back. But some of those people are brand new, never had any service before, showing up for the first time.
How are people hearing about it?
Well, that's the interesting thing. We have one of our work groups is a community education work group, and we have this wonderful plan to roll out information. And we've been doing some of that, but frankly, after July, when the numbers started going up so rapidly, we had to slow down a little bit because we want RHA to be able to hire staff, train staff, be ready to do a great job. So when we're feeling much more ready to do our soft opening and then our grand opening, you'll see more in the press, you'll see more targeted open houses on site. But we've been doing really just word of mouth, talking to different coalitions, different groups, different providers. We haven't really advertised. This has been really word of mouth that's brought these people in.
Ms. Pugh, I really like the quote from Representative Murphy about replace a hospital bed with jail cell, homeless shelter, or a coffin. We just can't sweep this under the rug. We're going to deal with these people one way or the other at some level. And I appreciate all of you at Smokey and RHA and Mandy, all the people that are involved here, because we've got to take care of these people. We can't just say it's not there, and we've got to fund it, we've got to work with you. Partnerships like this are just so advanced and so progressive because we can't do things the way we used to do. There's not the Smoky Mountain mental health we had, the monopoly that unfortunately got broken up. Probably not a good move looking back on it, but for y'all to do what you're doing, you're constantly trying to do hit targets that are changing all the time. I feel like you've had the rules change on you several times in a major way, and you still smile about it, you still keep trucking, and we appreciate that. It's a big deal, this commission, that we take care of people that have mental illness, and thank you for this great, it sounds like you've got it where you want to go. We roll it out more and more, we add to it. But these are people, as Commissioner Frost said, they're the people that don't expect anybody to help them. And when they do, we can do it cheaper, better, earlier, all the above, more efficiently. And thank all of you for taking time to be here. Wonderful report.
Thank you so much.
Any other comments or questions?
Well, I actually have one. So tell me how unique this model is.
It's very unique. There are potentially two other models in North Carolina that look somewhat like this, but do not have every component that we have put together under one roof. And we did a lot of discovery as we did our planning, so we tried to find the best national models. And there's some great models in Arizona and other states. But this is, for North Carolina, this is groundbreaking. We
nice.
Really believe that it is.
And what was the state grant that you got?
This was from Crisis Solutions Initiative.
And how much was it?
Over the course of the grant, it'll be more than $2 million. It helps us operational. It helps us in capital in the first 2 years, but then we are very hopeful for a continuation of about $500,000 a year for operations. These services will be very expensive to provide, and sustainability is kind of job number one for us, and we don't feel like we have that completely solved at this point. So continued advocacy will be necessary. To operate this full program each year is about a $4 billion price tag. Many of these services that came over with RHA were already budgeted for, were already in place. So everything is not a brand new budget, but to operate something like this for this number of people, it is expensive, but as you pointed out, much less expensive than some of the alternatives and with much more hopeful outcomes.
Thank you so much. Any other comments or questions? Thank all of you for coming tonight, and thank you for your good work for people that maybe can't say thank you or don't know how to say thank you the way we can. We appreciate you. Appreciate you, Mandy, for quarterbacking this and getting this together for us. Thank you. Okay, next up we have new business. We will take up a resolution accepting the bid for sale of surplus property, the Mary Benson House. Dr. Green, will you tell us about that?
Yes, sir. Commissioner, members of the board, we're here tonight to ask you to let us accept a bid and begin the accept bid process on a piece of property that we acquired in 2004 from the Blue Ridge Human Service Facility or Foundation. It was dissolved during mental health reform. We've had this property called the Mary Benson House on Montford for a long time, and since that time. And a number of months ago, y'all asked us to take a serious look at all the properties that we own and see what we could move off of our ownership and sell it to someone. We have received an offer from Pace Real Estate LLC for $595,000, which is the appraised price from April 2015, because they are a private company, not a nonprofit. We have to start the upset bid process. That's what we're here to ask you to do tonight. These funds, when we receive them, will be restricted for mental health use. That's the requirement of how we acquired the property. And we'll also ask, in the course of the motion, ask you to authorize us to accept the highest bid and execute the documents to transfer the property and then use these funds for the Family Justice Center. Any questions about it?
Any questions for our men?
So, just to remind myself, so we advertised, and then, is that true?
We didn't advertise yet. We received an offer.
Okay.
There's a relationship between Pace Real Estate and RHA, and a They will continue the same service there if they are the successful bidder in this process, but because they are a for-profit organization, we have to do an upset bid process. We cannot sell directly to a nonprofit.
Gotcha.
So, but the really nice thing on the other side is it's, it goes back on the tax roll.
Yep.
And I think there was also a question earlier of where this money would go, and you answered that.
So, yes, sir. It is very restrictive funding.
Any other questions or comments?
So since it's being sold to a for-profit entity under the state statute that we're following here, basically it's just going to go to the highest bidder. So if no one else bids, this is going to be the outcome. If no one else bids, then that will become the new.
Right. Well, the clerk will list it as a for an upset bid. Now that we've received an offer, we'll accept this initial offer and move forward. And then we'd like for y'all to authorize us to go ahead and accept the highest bid.
And what's the time period on that?
How many days between?
Gotcha.
Any other comments? No. Yes.
Okay.
So we're ready. No other questions for Dr. Green. We'll go ahead and we will go ahead and do a public hearing. I don't think it was advertised as such. Let's go ahead and do that. Any members of the public wish to be heard on that? Mr. Rice.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. This is an issue that's close to me. And I do, you know, the presentation that you heard is not even a thumbnail sketch of the seriousness of this matter. The state of North Carolina is going in an opposite direction to any other state or most other states, and that is that they are not providing the money for this service. Buncombe County is providing a lot of service, a lot of money. On this money that we're designating here tonight, and it's going to the Justice Center, I absolutely have been in favor of the Justice Center, and I told you that. But I don't think this money should be designated for that purpose when you're already getting $2 million or better for the Justice Center through the federal government. This money needs to go to the priority of the needs that you just heard tonight in the areas that they're talking about where the needs really exist that we need to be dealing with. This Justice Center never appeared until recently. And let me tell you, it's a hole. This Justice Center is a hole for fraud, period. I want you to mark that word down in your dictionary, fraud. It's a national thing that the government is keeping their eyes on because this ain't the first Justice Center in America. But I tell you, this money that we're talking about out of the Benson House needs to go to the priorities of what you just heard from the mental health folks. And if you want some more information, we certainly can get you more numbers. If you like numbers, we can get you plenty. Go with it. But make sure this money goes for the real purpose and not for what you're projecting in the future. Projecting, don't get it. We got real numbers. Let's work on that.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Rice. Any other members of the public wish to be heard? All right, Dr. Green, do you have...
No, I just wanted to make sure that we got the motion so we can begin the process.
Can you rephrase? Can you say that again?
We need you to declare your intent to accept an offer for this property, direct the clerk to publish a notice, authorize the manager and appropriate staff to accept the highest bid. We do have the right to reject any bid that comes in as we go through the process. And then execute the documents for the highest bid. And we're going to have to bring back a budget amendment to allocate the funds.
So
moved. There's been a motion by Commissioner Jones, a second by Vice Chair Newman. Is there any discussion?
Just a comment. We're not directing the funds. We're authorizing the sale and upset bid tonight, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Any other discussion or questions? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. The resolution is adopted by 7-0 vote. Next, we have Coburn Earth Science Museum funding request, also known as Asheville Museum of Science. Mr. Newman and crowd, if y'all will come up and tell us about your proposal and your request.
I am the executive director for the Colburn Earth Science Museum. Last fiscal year, we requested $275,000 from the Buncombe County Community Fund, which unfortunately we did not receive your vote. However, we were advised to return once we are a little bit further along with our project. I come before you today because we are over halfway towards our funding goal, and we are in the middle of our planning and design phase of the project. So today I'm asking the county for $50,000 as an out-of-cycle funding request for the relocation and rebranding of the museum. Most of you are familiar with this project. Either myself or John Newman, the president of our board, have come to you to discuss this project. But as a refresher, the Colburn Earth Science Museum was established in 1960, and we are currently located in the basement of the Pack Place. In addition to being a museum, we offer North Carolina standard-based science education to visiting school groups and families through either field trips, after-school groups, or summer programs, just to name a few. Last year, we were provided an opportunity to move out of Pack Place. The board, along with a consulting firm, conducted a feasibility study and it was decided that we would relocate and rebrand the museum. We will be moving to the Wells Fargo building adjacent to Pritchard Park in downtown Asheville and unveiling our new name as the Asheville Museum of Science. This rebranding will allow us to broaden our mission, which includes more than just earth science. It incorporates life science and STEM skills, which stands for science, technology, engineering, and math. We will keep a smaller Colburn Hall of Minerals as a permanent exhibit to maintain our legacy. However, we will incorporate new interactive and state-of-the-art exhibits. A couple of these exhibits include our Magic Planet Theater, which will be a ticketed showing daily. We'll also be able to have an interactive display of planetary and climate data sets. We will be purchasing a life-size dinosaur replica, which can either be stored or displayed in-house or broken down and taken to outreach programming at schools throughout Buncombe County and Western North Carolina. Wells Fargo Building presents the Asheville Museum of Science with a highly discernible street-level presence. We will be nearly doubling our current exhibit and classroom space in an 8,000-square-foot location. It will also house our offices and an extended gift shop space. We anticipate a significant increase in admission and gift shop sales in this new location, which will help us to become a more sustainable science center. We're also very excited about all the new partnerships that we are forming with this campaign, some of which include NOAA, UNCA, and the Collider. These partnerships, among many others, will help us expand our programming, volunteer and internship opportunities, as well as fundraising. Last month in December, we launched our Spotlight campaign, which is short for Moving Science Education into the Spotlight. We've embarked on a $1.2 million fundraising goal over the next 3 years, with a grand opening date set for the spring of 2016. I'm happy to announce that we have raised over $600,000 through various foundations, corporations, and individuals. $400,000 of that has come from the Buncombe County Tourism Product Development Fund, which requires matching funds. So any funding that the county approves would be 100% matched by this grant. So we're requesting the county to provide $50,000 to go towards phase one of our construction to help develop the Asheville Museum of Science. If approved, This would expedite our timeline in order to serve Buncombe County Schools and other Western North Carolina schools by the fall semester of 2016. It would also help us be respectful of our current co-tenants in the PAC Place, the Apple Art Museum, and Diana Wortham Theater are going to be expanding their operations into our current location. That is all I have for you today. Thank you so much, Commissioner Gant, for advising us to be on today's agenda. And thank you all so much for your time and consideration of this very important project to move science education into the public.
I'd like to make a motion to approve this, but I just had a question for the county manager. Is it possible, instead of taking the $50,000 from fund balance, to take it from monies allocated for other art projects, the art museum? Is that possible to do that instead of taking the money from fund balance?
We do have, I have to look at the exact number, but about $500,000 set aside for the art museum itself. That's setting in reserve. If we wanted to borrow the money from there, we could.
To me, that just makes sense to do. This is going to expedite the art museum moving ahead with their expansion. I remind myself all the time of the stress on the fund balance from a sheriff that coerced confessions from people. So if we can be creative and think of another way, then to do this. But that's my motion. I'd like to approve this with the money coming from the $500,000 for the art museum.
I need to be clear if, like, I'm fine with however, you know, borrowing it from different funds, but I don't want to set everybody going nuts that, like, we're somehow or another we're taking away money from the art museum. So I'd like that to be very clear that we're not necessarily reducing our allocation
right.
that we've already made, but we're just utilizing those funds,
mm-hmm.
right? So that everybody, so going out into the world, there is
yes.
not a rumor about that.
Well, I'm not clear what's the difference. If we take it out, where's the money? How is it not a reduction?
It would be.
I think the agreement with the art museum was that they wouldn't receive any money until they started construction on their new project. So
mm-hmm.
I think that's still a way is off.
So the commitment we made to the art museum project is still the same level. But since we're not using those funds this year,
right.
those funds.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's basically, it's borrowing the money, but we've got to give it back. So next year, instead of giving them $500, we've got to give them $550. So, but this is, I don't see this myself personally right now. It's a life or death issue, whether we get a fund or we're going to borrow the money from another source. It's not giving the money, it's borrowing the money. It means we've got to give the money back to the art museum. So that's, you know, there's other things that needs things right now that are more important than pushing the issue of this. Look at Art Space out in our district. They just went through a flood. That seems to be a little more important. We can't give them 10 cents.
That's a charter school. It's a totally
different. It don't really matter. It's a school and it has children. This is an art place that has children. This has rocks. This has different things. The charter school has 400 kids in it. 42% of them, I went out there yesterday to see them that. And 42% of these kids are under poverty. So call it whatever you want to call it. But they're trying to raise $25,000. And I'm going to try to help them raise $25,000. Just giving $50 away, whether it's fund balance or off of something else, I'm not for. They can come back during the regular session in May and ask us for money again, as far as I'm concerned.
Dr. Green, so we've kind of asked questions and then given our own opinion. Will you explain how $50,000 would be diverted or not? What Commissioner Frost has proposed, can you explain how you would do that or how that would work?
I'm just sitting here figuring how we would do that. This is $500,000 that's setting a separate fund that we would take $50,000 of that now from that fund and make this payment, and then in a future budget we would replace the $50,000 when the art museum is actually ready for the funding.
So that would be addressed in a typical replacing the $50,000
would be replaced in a future budget
in a typical budget cycle.
Okay, it's been a motion. I'll make a second to that, as she has stated it, which would be to take from one account to borrow some money instead of... You have separate accounts, many accounts in our budget. We're just taking, instead of fund balance, we're taking from the account that has been set up for the art museum to be replaced. And as Commissioner Jones said, this is not taking away money from them as much as borrowing on an existing account that they have and have not used at this point.
Correct. That's correct.
Okay. Okay, there's been a motion, a second. Any further discussion?
I'm a little confused. First of all, let me say that I am a fan of the museum, and if this was at budget time, I'm checking. $50,000, no problem. We're sitting here in March on a community development grant. The problem is that the money is out of cycle, and that there's been a motion on how to deal with that. And I'm still confused on it. So it sounds like to me that we are saying that I think it was $250 last year to the art museum. I'm not sure. So you would be taking that out of that $250,000.
I think we've done $250 for a couple of years, and we have a $500,000 sitting in reserve for the art museum to be used when they actually proceed with their construction. So what we could do is take $50,000, in essence, from that money that's just sitting there unused but would be used in the future, and then replace it in the next budget cycle.
How would we replace it?
You would have to do an appropriation in the general fund, in the regular community development funding, to put this back into that fund.
I just thought of that because it's helping the art museum the sooner Coburn can adios.
And we're talking about this. Are there any legal issues that we need to consider? Can that be done?
It can be done. Funds are all under your control.
So if we have a $500,000 that is fungible, then we could use that for the HHS and not pull from fund balance. I mean, I wonder, is that a slippery slope when we start doing things like that?
I don't think it's a slippery slope when you decide to use money. I just think that the $500,000 is sitting there really for the art museum, and this does help them move that forward. I think the health and human service money is really core service and something that's paid for in the general fund and belongs in the general fund.
We're just talking about debt, you know, pulling out of the reserves versus not.
Well, I hear what you're saying, but I also need to tell you that as a manager, the human service piece is core service.
Sure.
And is paid for out of the general fund, and I think that's where it actually belongs. The other is... It has more in to do with the art museum and their ability to move forward. If I sit here and try and think my way through it,
it goes back to one more thing. We held $2 million back from Eagle Market Street until they get the building done. Now that's another issue, but from what I understand, we borrowed the money to put into general fund to make our balance work. So now, what is the difference between doing that for a nonprofit and then taking money for the general fund to out of that to help manuscript?
Those are real specific uses that you have some discretion around. I don't think you have as much discretion around core service. And I would tell you the $2 million is also a loan that we will at some point pay back. That is the last dollar in on Eagle Market Street, and I anticipate it's a while before they will need those funds. But during the budget process, I think we were pretty clear that was a loan back to the general fund.
This is basically a loan out of that fund to pay for this, but we have to put it back to in our next cycle.
If you're going to borrow out of this fund, yeah, you do have to.
It's no different if we take it from fund balance. It's $50,000. Or if we loan it to us, it's still $50,000 that we're going to have to pay back.
That's true, but it's a matter of how you'll end the year, in all honesty, when the funds will be needed. you know, we are facing that fairly large settlement that I do not think we're going to be able to cover that. I do work hard to cover the fund balance we have appropriated. So I think this year we have a different challenge than what we've had in the past, but I also believe funds set aside for very specific uses have a different, there's different flexibility than there is for core services that we pay for out of the general fund.
Well, I want to pay for all the core services we need out of the general fund. I just can't see we borrow money and then it runs the budget up next year, another $50,000 on something that we've done this year. Because we, no matter if we put it back next year or the year after, whenever it comes up, sooner or later, once the number comes to where they start building our center, we have to have the money for it.
We do. I mean, at that point in time, you've made the commitment. And we'll come, you know, I anticipate it's still several months into the future before that payment's needed. Would point out that we did borrow the $2 million to avoid an increase or an adjustment in our tax rate, too. So that was an important consideration in the course of the budget. I'm sorry, just to be clear, if this resolution passes, will it add to county debt? It will add to what the general fund would owe a reserve fund.
But we're not digging into the savings account to pay for this.
At this point, we're not.
But if we go into next year and the budget don't change that much, if we have to go more into the fund balance next year at the end of the year for different things, will that change the numbers?
It's hard to...
I know you carry a fund balance all the time.
We do carry a fund balance, and we appropriate a fund balance all the time. I just think sitting here in January, it's really hard to say what a budget for 17 is going to look like. But I would say we would need $50,000 out of the general fund or out of your appropriation to pay back the Art Museum Fund. But today, it does keep the fund balance from going up, and we've already taken it up by $8 million.
That's what I understand. And that's, you know, it's still giving money away a little early, but whatever they decide then is that for me.
Hey, I'd like to make a couple of comments.
Yes, sir.
So, and I appreciate the, you know, in terms of the specifics of the drawing of funds, I mean, I think the intent is to, you know, there is this really unique thing that's happened to the county budget this year, this one-time event that's had a big impact on, it's got a big impact on the fund balance this year, so any ideas to kind of address that so that they can, at the end of the day, we are making this investment, the county's making this investment of $50,000, that can kind of hit on the budget impact for next year, I think that's a good idea, but at the end of the day, I think the most important question here is whether or not Buncombe County should be a partner in this awesome project, and I think we definitely should. And so these are important questions, but I think at the end of the day, whether the budget effect is in this fiscal year or in next fiscal year is you know, sort of a secondary question. And so I just sort of want to get back to the core part of the request that's on the table here. And I'm really excited about this project. I think this is going to be a great new home for this facility that so many people in the community use. It's going to be so much more high profile and visible. I think it's going to be very successful. The request that's being made to Buncombe County to invest $50,000 out of a $1.2 million budget. I think is for this kind of community facility is a very reasonable, very modest request. It's going to leverage a lot of private funds. I know that you guys are out there working really hard to raise a lot of funds from the private sector, and that's as it should be. But for a community facility such as this, clearly Buncombe County should be a partner in the project as well. So. For all those reasons, I'm really supportive of it, and appreciate what y'all are doing. It's going to be a great project. So thanks for what you're doing. And I think that in terms of just the timing on it, because I do think the question about funding, funding projects like this outside of just the regular budget cycle is a very fair question. So I think there has to be a good reason for why we would do that. I think there are in this case. You know, when the project came to us When this proposal came to us last year, it was a much bigger request. Frankly, we could not afford it, consistent with the tax rate that we had and that we wanted to set in last year's budget. But the things that have changed since then, of course, the Tourism Development Authority committing $400,000 towards the project, and good for them for doing that. It's a great investment. And that is a challenge grant. So for the county to invest $50,000 behind this project now will do tremendously more good towards the success of this campaign that they are working on than if we wait and we fund it, you know, this summer. So we need to show that we're for this project. I think that sends a really important signal to other community partners, private sector partners, that we think this is going to be a great thing for Asheville and Buncombe County. And we don't need to be the last group in. It's much more valuable to be speaking up in favor of it now.
That's one more question, one more comment. My wife asked me a question. Why are they changing the name of Colburn? She said she went there when she was a kid. Well, that they opened it in 1960. That was a good question, I thought, because what if they decided to just go ahead and change the name of Biltmore House? You know, why can't it just stay Colburn what it is without us paying for all this new signage and stuff for it? You know, that's basically what this is for, signage, and to make the stuff look the way they want to make it look. So.
Wait a minute, Mike, you've talked a lot, I hadn't talked much, but I'll wait a little bit more.
Okay, go ahead, Mike.
The fact is, if they could wait 3 months, they waited, you know, they got $400,000, but they asked for $450,000. That's what tourism and development's for, is to try to help areas that kids are going to play on, ball fields or whatever. That's why we raised the tax 2 cents. So I don't understand, you know, why couldn't they come back during the time? And yeah, I'm sure we could give them $50,000 during the year. But coming this early, you know, and it's just bending over, and here we are. We just give away more money again.
Commissioner Jones?
So, first of all, awesome job on everything. And y'all have really been going against the odds. You've had a lot of things that have been hard to keep on going between. Anyway, we all know what we're talking about. But so, way to persevere, and way to hold on to the past and really celebrate your history and all the goodness that has happened there. Because my daughter had so many great, summer camp and school trips, and those Friday night evenings for parents were awesome. And she learned so much in all that too. And so way to celebrate that history, but move forward in a way with a name that people from outside will understand. I don't think it's so they can have fancy pants signage. I think it's so more people will understand, because as much as some of the folks of us that have frequented the Colburn know what the Colburn is, most people on the street don't know what Colburn is. But they'll know what Asheville Museum of Science is. It's going to be very clear, very transparent, very exciting. So that's the answer to the question, is so it's clear to the people what it is. I think it's great that y'all are kind of holding both those intention. And as Commissioner Newman said, that, you know, good for the Tourism Development Authority for investing in y'all, because, you know, a lot of folks have said, well, let's find ways to bring children and families to our community. And y'all are doing that. That is awesome. And so thank you for that. And I think that's going to benefit our community. But I'm excited about this investment because of what I see it doing for the children of Buncombe County, the school children of Asheville City Schools, for the charter schools, for the homeschoolers, for the private schoolers, and for Buncombe County. All those children that are in all sorts of educational settings, they come to y'all, right? I mean, y'all are probably one of the few groups that touch all those folks. And those are all our constituents here in Buncombe County. And with a pretty modest investment, we are able to expedite that service to those families and those children here in Buncombe County. because it's really one of those projects that does both things. It allows people from the outside to learn and to visit and to experience science and education, but it also allows our children to benefit as well. So I think it's I'm as someone that's been part of, you know, raising funds over the years, there are times in campaigns that matter more than others, and this is a time that it really matters for y'all. And it's, you know, $50,000 now is really different than $50,000 later. It really is. So I think that we have that flexibility, and we will benefit, our community will benefit exponentially for it. So for all those reasons, I'm very excited about your project. I'm very excited about playing a part in moving this forward and moving the design forward and all the other visions there. And so I'll be supporting this with a lot of cheers and raucous.
I just have one other question. How many school children went through last year?
Last fiscal year, 14 and 15, we had almost 9,000 students come through. We served 35 Buncombe County schools. 23 of those were public. The rest were private, charter, and home schools. And we served 57 total schools throughout Western North Carolina.
Fantastic.
Really, do you have programs for low-income or needs-based attendance?
Yes, our price for school groups is significantly lower than just an admission rate to accommodate for lower income children.
When I break it down, I think we've hit on all the points. I won't rehash everything, but three parts to your request. One of them is the merits. I think it's just fantastic. We talk all the time about we need more family-centered events. We need more science. We support STEM. We've opened up the first STEM school in Western North Carolina. That's where the future is, and we've got to respect that. You've got the second thing I look at is the timing, and I think Commissioner Jones covered this. This means more now than it's going to mean later. I would normally not support something out of cycle because I think we do have a procedure. But we told you to come back when you're ready to move. You're ready to move. Art museums are ready to take space. And you got to, and then finally you get a match on top of that. So I just, it seems to me, but the third part is the future, and I really endorse and appreciate you working to become self-sufficient. Because if you have a high visibility gift store, you are going to head that way in a fast motion. Because you're going to be floor level, you've got a great product, you're trying to expand it into more science, not just the rocks. I assume that Coburn's had no problem or no disagreement with your plans, or else you wouldn't be doing it. Is that right, Anna?
Yeah, we discussed this with them early on in the relocation and rebranding stage. So, and John talked with their, obviously Mr. Coburn is no longer with us, but his granddaughter, and there have been no disagreements whatsoever.
And I suspect, I think from conversation maybe with you and John, they want to see it grow. They want to see it get bigger. They don't want to stay in the basement and be small. And who knows what you can do with your location. So based on merits, timing, and the future plans you have, I think this is one of the exceptions I would make to take it out of cycle. And that's why I suggested we talk about it tonight. So thank you for being here. Any other comments? We do have a motion in a second. Any other comments? This is our time to talk about it.
Yeah, I've got a couple as we finish up. Just want to say, and you may or may not know this, but for the last 3 years, I've been on the TDA representing the board. I've been very, very vocal in children's oriented activities, pushing for visit the Coburn Center early, and extremely concerned that you were being moved out of that area. My grandson will be going there in just a few days. I'm a very big supporter and have been advocating for this. And I believe have a little part in that $400,000 that you just received. Mm-hmm. And if this was budget time, I would give you more than $50,000. I'm just not comfortable with the motion, and so I'll be voting no.
But I want to encourage you to come back during that cycle. I want you, to continue to stir that vision, because I think it's a good one. I think it's very sustainable. I think it's great for Buncombe County, and I appreciate that very much.
Okay, any other comments or questions?
There's somebody in the audience.
You're not taking public comment unless the commissioner requested. Call a question. All those in favor of the proposal by Commissioner Frost, second by the chair, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no?
No.
I counted 4-3, Commissioner Jones, Vice Chair Newman, Chairman, and Jones 4, Belcher, DeBrule, and Fryer against. Is that right? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Next we have the realignment and reallocation of the Health and Human Services position. And we have Mary Stone to talk about that.
Chairman and Commissioners, as Max pulls up the PowerPoint, I just want to share a few comments. One, as you know, North Carolina is one of 11 states that are state supervised and county administered in the areas of social services and public health. That basically means that the federal government and the state set all of the rules and all of the requirements, and the county's responsible for the administration of those programs. That means that counties are responsible for a portion of the funding of those programs. What I put in your packets are all the laws that govern the two areas I want to talk about tonight, but what's in front of you are the two main laws that basically say the federal government and the state will set the rules and the expectations, and we will fund our portion and deliver the service. That said, I also want to make the point that I think we have a track record of trying very hard to manage our resources. Dr. Green is very clear in her expectations around that for department heads, and we'll make every effort between now and the end of the fiscal year to do that. We bring it to you because there are substantial liabilities associated with the issue tonight, and because while there are no new positions in this, this is reallocating positions that already sit in Health and Human Services. It would be a reoccurring expense. So in fairness, we felt like we should bring it. I do bring you the commitment. We shall attempt to manage these additional dollars within our own budget to the extent we can. That said, I also want to make the point that beyond the law, these are our citizens. There are close to 20,000 families who rely on food assistance, and the action that we're going to talk about tonight is specific to timely benefits, receipt of timely benefits within federal guidelines. And that really is the difference between families and elderly and disabled adults having the resources they need to eat. And I don't want to lose sight of those families. So I also feel compelled to say to you that while I will talk about FNS or food and nutrition services tonight, they're not delivered in a vacuum. They're delivered in an economic services division that processes 72,000 cases a year, 6,000 a month. So as we manage resources, it's broader than just the FNS requirement. The federal government, and I will be the first to admit, I've stood here and said this related to Medicaid in the last year as well, but the federal government put North Carolina and many other states on notice that they were out of compliance with the 95% benchmark for the timely delivery of services. And I want to talk a little bit about the detail related to that in just a minute. What they basically did is issue to North Carolina what they call an advance warning, where they said, you're out of compliance. We have to see an aggressive corrective action plan. We have to see you meet an even higher goal, moving from 85 to 95% timeliness in the period of January to June of this year. And if you fail to meet that, what's at risk for your federal reimbursement for administration, which is about $76 million for the state of North Carolina. What I know this board is aware of, because we've talked about it before, the risk for Buncombe in terms of administrative funds around FNS services is almost $8 million a year. The loss of those dollars would not equate to us stopping to deliver the service. It would require we continue to deliver the service, but without those additional federal dollars, which the state has the authority to require of us because we act as agents of the state.
why we are so challenged as a state, and we'll talk about the state as a whole, and we'll talk about Buncombe County specifically, and we've talked about this before, it's the continuing adaption to the NC FAST system, which has just dramatically changed our work. Y'all have seen the numbers before. We are very data-driven. We measure those. It takes us twice as long to do every function in NC FAST, and that certainly had an impact on this. In addition, in terms of the Affordable Care Act, it did add a new category of Medicaid for states called MAGI, which means we have, even in terms of family Medicaid, we have different income and asset requirements for some Medicaid programs than others, and that's added time. As the USDA looked around at states and their compliance around food nutrition services, they also said to some states, North Carolina being one, we want to change how we interpret a timely benefit. For all of my career, they interpreted the timely delivery of benefits as we approve the application within 7 days if it's expedited, meaning an emergency case, or within 30 days for regular FNS applications. They came back this year and said, the delivery of timely benefits means you've approved it, it's gone to the central system, the card's been issued, and the consumer has the benefits in their hand. The impact for us is that reduced our time to complete expedited applications by 4 days and our time to complete regular applications by 5 days. When you multiply that out by a caseload of 20,000, it's a substantial additional work requirement for us. This is, if you look at the urbans, and I'm focusing on the urban counties in North Carolina because the truth is in North Carolina, most of the social services work is concentrated in those largest counties. And if those largest counties do not meet federal requirements, North Carolina can't meet federal requirements. This shows you the yellow being the urban county average, the orange being the North Carolina average, and the red being Buncombe County. I share this to say we have been fairly consistent in our performance. We continue to make progress in our performance around time standards, even with this new requirement moving us from 85 to 95% timeliness and the reduction in days we have to process. What I would point out to you is if you can see all those gray lines for the other counties, very erratic performance, and that's about continuing to have to deal with a new system at the same time you're dealing with these new increased standards. What we need have been focused on is a sustainable business model, and that's what I bring to you tonight around economic services. Philip Harden, who's here, our economic services director, and his staff has spent a lot of time talking to states who have made substantial progress in completing applications the same day they come in. For us, that's been a huge cultural shift because we had built a system in North Carolina that said apply online, mail in your application, do anything but come to your local DSS. We are now having to totally change that culture and focus on how do we get the message to individuals, encourage them to come in, complete their interviews, and us process their applications in the same day. We've also focused very heavily on quality. You know, are we also delivering the right amount of benefits based on those federal rules and regulations to the right people in the right time, in the right manner? So we focused heavily on that. And what I bring to you tonight is really and I want to talk a little bit about just a minute. This is a trend line that shows we're moving in the right direction. The green trend, the line on the bottom is the number of same day applications. When we're processing the application the same day the individual comes in. On the top is the trend line around mail-ins and walk-ins. We began this process where 95% of the people we serve never came in the door. I say that to recognize the work by our communication team and on Phillips' staff and with community partners to reverse that education to our consumer groups and encourage them to come in, complete their applications, and allow us to process them more timely. This I want to talk about because I think this is a really important point. One of the things that I think Dr. Green has driven in Buncombe County that has the most substantial impact on our work is how we use data. You don't see that in other counties. And particularly as we've moved into an NC-FAST system where the data that comes out of that system is inconsistent and where there have been integrity issues, our ability to build our own data warehouses and draw on that, these are examples of what we're tracking every, I look at these, as does Philip and all of his team, every single day, from an agency average to a unit average to a division average down to an individual person, gives us the ability to know who is or isn't meeting standards and why. Where are they making those errors? And then we use that to train and redesign our processes, some of what we're going to talk about today. This is just another example of that. I know y'all get a dashboard every day on our financial performance. Department heads get a dashboard every day on their programmatic performance across all programs. This is really us saying what we did to survive in the first round of NC-FAST is build teams that had technical expertise. We had policy expertise. We didn't have technical expertise. This redesign is saying I need to pull those experts out and put them in line supervision and line income maintenance positions so that the people interfacing every day with the public can process those applications on the same day. The bottom line of this redesign in economic services adds 12 workers and 2 supervisors to the front line to interface with citizens every day and process applications. The way that we draw down reimbursement in economic services, this redesign actually saves us $40,000 a year. So I'd want to make that point. What we gain with this is providing the staffing supports at that front door, at the interface with our consumers and our community, and moving positions out of administration to do that. And I'm happy to answer questions at the end or along the way. The second redesign I bring to you is specific to social work services, although it's very similar. This again is me saying to you, here are the numbers. If you want to look at the numbers, we receive almost 5,000 reports a year related to child abuse and neglect. We complete almost 2,300 investigations, serve about 500 families at any time in their own home, and successfully 95% of those remain safely in their own home. We have about 418 children who were legally responsible for with court intervention. But all of those numbers really relate back to children and families and our ability to deliver timely and quality comprehensive assessments, assess risk, and put the right services in place. What we've seen, and I'm going to talk through this, I know it's not easy to see, what we've seen that has driven a lot of our workload in social work is the complexity of the situations. 25% increase in the cases we deal with where substance abuse is the primary issue. To go back to the presentation by Smokey and Mr. Rice's comments, we are clearly seeing that. On those cases where we know there are identified substance abuse issues, we do ongoing testing through hair follicle of those children. And I would say to you, we tested 116 children in a 6-month period, ranging in age from 10 years old to 6 months. 70% of those children showed exposure to toxic drug substances in their home. 70%. You can't fix that in 12 months. We don't. The behavioral supports aren't out there in the community in North Carolina or in the nation, and those are more long-term issues that have to be dealt with. How that impacts us is we can't close cases as quickly. We have to continue to be involved and assure the safety of those children. We have seen growth in the number of children entering foster care, and we can talk about that trend line in a minute, but the point I want to make to you, and I think this is a good thing, is we've become a trauma-informed community. Our judges are ordering more frequent visitation, as they should. Tammy Shook is in the back, and Katie Swanson, our program administrators in Children's Services, who deal with this every day on the front line. It is not unusual for a judge to order us to do 6 hours of visits between a biological parent and a child in a week. Any of us who are parents say, yay, that's exactly what they ought to order us to do and keep that family bond strong. But that takes social work time to supervise those visits, document, report them back to the court. And some, those are some of the factors that are really driving our work. We've also seen, which I'm going to show some data about in a minute, we, much like the Sheriff's Department EMS, really operate 24/7 now. Mm-hmm. You look at us at any given time, we probably have 24/7, clearly over the holidays, as we can all attest, we probably have 6 staff in the field at any given time. What happens because our staff rotate to cover backup on call is that continues to absorb other staff time. This shows you the caseload, the top one being foster care, increasing the number of kids entering into care. The blue one showing you our assessment lines, that is a very consistent trend line for us every year and across the nation. Where you see large spikes tend to be when school's about to be out. Everybody who's worried about any child being home for the summer tends to make reports in those last few months before school. So that's a traditional spike for us. And the orange line being those families where you have identified risk and are serving while the children remain in the home. I want to talk about how we're seeing this impact staff, because social workers are working longer hours to meet their federal and state requirements and benchmarks, and because of the complexity of cases. What I really have is a social work staff who's earning 2.5 weeks every month of overtime. They have to be compensated for that time, but that's time away when they take it. And I'll be honest with you, I'm not comfortable having social workers working 24 straight hours attempting to do the complex assessments they're required to do. This shows you, although we have dedicated on-call staff, and we are very grateful for that, because we've seen the increase in demand in the hours that we're seeing requests for immediate services, we're having to use our daytime staff to provide backup. What this says to you, the blue is adults and the red is child services, but this is the amount of time our daytime staff are pulled to cover backup on call. That equates to somewhere between 1 to 3 weeks every month. The same people who have to respond to reports and deal with children and adults at risk during the day are also working overtime at night to cover the amount of crisis services. What we know happens with that, and that is well-researched and evidence-based, is it increases turnover. While our turnover is still well below the state national average, we saw a 50% increase in turnover, and the vast majority of particularly in in-home, our supervisory staff are very inexperienced because of that turnover. What happens when you have turnover and you operate, and that's why your budget amendment is 10 pages long. I really wanted to make the point, we operate in a world that says you'll see them in 24 hours or you'll see them in 48 hours. You'll complete every task within a certain time frame, and these are the tasks you have to complete. Because that work has to get done, whether I'm down positioned or not, it has to be covered. The impact to that is we really have 7 of our full-time staff unavailable for work at any given time because of either turnover, FMLA, which you see in a very high-stress trauma environment, or compensating their time off that they've earned because of on-call. What we're really asking to do is to redesign our social work business operation to add 5 direct social work staff, again using existing positions within Health and Human Services and 1 supervisor. The state requires we maintain a 1-to-5 ratio between supervisors and workers. They also require a certain caseload size for us, 10 investigations, 10 in-home cases, and up to 15 foster care, but those are very restricted numbers for us that are actually within the law. So we're asking to take existing positions and add 5 social workers. Part of those will increase on call, so we're actually able to have more of a 24/7 shift and not keep pulling daytime staff to do after hours work. Part of them will serve as floaters, so when we have a vacancy, we have a body to fill it. North Carolina requires, and I totally support this, any social worker hired in North Carolina in Child Protective Services has to complete 72 hours of pre-service whether they're a fully qualified social worker or not before they can touch a case. That means even when we hire new people, if we're unable to hire those already pre-service trained, they can't immediately go to work. We have to send them away to complete their pre-service, which also impacts that. With Phillip's side of the house, the redesign saves $40,000. The unfortunate part, as y'all know, on the social work side is those are all capped allocations. And we took a reduction in Child Protective Services money in the last budget cycle from the state. For us, that was about $225,000. It will cost $119,000 to put all of these new positions on the ground. Again, I make the point, I fully understand Dr. Green's expectation. We try to manage within our budget, and we will attempt to do that. She and I both felt this board had a right to know, one, we were taking on those reoccurring expenses, and two, that that North Carolina had been put on advance notice that could place our administrative dollars at risk. And I'm happy to answer any questions. I know it's late and everybody's tired, but I am going to ask Katie and Tammy and Phillip to just stand up. These really are the people who drive these services all day for you. I'm happy to answer any questions. I know one question that was asked, that has been asked or come up before is it possible for there to be any waivers on any of these timelines? And the feds have been very clear that it is not. I mean, we really are restricted by what they are. I think that's a very valid question, and one that North Carolina's looked at, and the feds have been very clear. You gotta hit 95%, you gotta stay at 95%. This has reached a level, as Dr. Green can tell you, that the county managers in the urban counties are receiving daily updates. And there is a meeting in Greensboro involving the Secretary of DHHS, the county managers, and their DHH or DSS directors, because, you know, North Carolina has $76 million at risk related to this.
Ms. Stone, am I correct that one out of five of the residents in Buncombe County use HHS services? That's on.
You are correct.
100%.
I move approval of these of the request for these new positions.
Motion by Commissioner Jones, second by Commissioner Hodges.
How would you like me to award it?
These are not new positions. They are actually positions we could move around. But what we're really asking for approval for is the additional funds out of the fund balance. I would tell you that is just what it will take for the rest of this year. When we do the budget, you'll see the full impact of it, which is going to be well over $200,000.
Okay, so the request is about the allocation of the additional dollars. Okay.
Okay, so there's been a motion, second. Okay, yes, ma'am.
Dr. Green clarified that. I just wanted to clarify that these weren't new hires coming on, that you're actually reshuffling personnel that we have to make it work.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, thank you.
But just out of curiosity, so, because I guess the title and the agenda was what kind of threw me, because you are creating new, there's no new people, I get that, but the position itself is newly framed?
No, the position exists within HHS. We've actually pulled any clerical position, any vacant position anywhere except in these two areas, and we're reclassing them to either income maintenance or social work positions.
I see, so it's a reclassification.
And in the economic services side, we got 50 to 75% reimbursement, and we actually save money when we add staff.
Okay.
Sorry, on the social work side, it's capped, and there are no dollars to support it except county dollars.
I'm really supportive, but I was thinking about those social workers. Do they get, are they able to access mental health, or because I'm concerned about fatigue and just what they encounter in a day is beyond what most of us would ever, do they have access to that?
They do. We actually contract for full-time trauma, secondary trauma position that supports staff. We also partner with the city and other first responders to share an additional contract position related to that. You make a really good point. The data is staggering, and you know, in the
last year in the United States, you have a child protective service worker who was murdered knocking on a door. That always impacts dramatically your ability to recruit people to do this work. And these are people who don't live in the office. They are out knocking on doors at 3 o'clock in the morning assessing safety of children.
So is it safe to say that you are making these moves within the department to reduce the stress on the existing team members and improve the services to the children and those that are receiving them in Buncombe County?
Absolutely. More frontline folks, pulling it anywhere we can to put them on the front line, they interface with our citizens.
And I am reminded of something. I've used this before. I've said it before, and if the Lord would permit me, is a verse that I'm reminded of when we start talking about the needs of these children and adults in Buncombe County. It's Jude 22, and on some having compassion, making a difference. And clearly what you're doing and what this does today, it makes a measurable difference, in life and death difference in Buncombe County. And it's pretty easy for me to support.
Any other questions or comments from the board?
This is very easy for me to support. This is the way fund balance should be used when it's needed for good people like sitting back at the Ringfeld and the help from that work. I know what they went through on this NC Fast deal. It was early in the morning till late at night to try to get it to work. Thank you very much. I will support you in any way I can. But I'll be fully engaged in this because, Ms. Stone, you don't want people working for 24 hours because you're right, because they will have something different to do. And so just check me in on this. But thank all of you. It's not just one person. It takes the whole crew to make it work. So thank you.
Anything else from the board? All right. We've had a motion, and a motion Commissioner Jones, second Commissioner Belcher. Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. The motion carries 7-0. Thank you, ma'am. Next we have from the consent agenda, the Economic Development Coalition bylaws.
Madam Chairman, that's a fairly sobering act to follow, and the work that we do. I'm really proud of the staff we have, the work that we do, and I'm not sure people know, if you're not around us all the time, just the difference we make in lives. I'm proud to be part of, associated with that group. On the Economic Development Coalition, there's three basic things that we're changing in our policy. The first deals with, right now, the way the Economic Development Coalition is set up is we have 9 appointed members, and they are all appointed by this board. Recommendations are made by certain people, but they're appointed by this board. We have a number of people who are CEOs of different organizations that are ex officios in the and members of EDC. Those include Buncombe County Schools, Asheville City Schools, AV Tech, City, County, Airport, and Manufacturers Executive. There's a number of them. And this lets the Economic Development membership add any other senior member of one of these organizations that they deem to be needed. In the room, for instance, John Crichton and Sam Powers of the city, people who are day-to-day involved in economic development. So this is a change to do that. It also clarifies who can vote and who can't. Like, ex officios cannot vote, and these other members that we add cannot vote. And it changes it to say who can be in closed session and at the discretion of the board. So these new members can also be in closed session. Currently, ex officio members are in closed session, and this expands it to say that these new members we add could go to closed session too. It's really fairly simple changes. I've been on EDC a long time, and we really try to adjust and meet the needs and bring the resources we need to the table. How you recruit business and how you expand existing business has changed so much over time. I remember 20 years ago it was a water and sewer line. Today, it's so different. So very, very different. So This has been reviewed and requested by the chamber, reviewed and suggested by our legal department, and we're just asking to make those changes. Any questions?
All righty. Any discussion? Is there a motion to adopt?
Well, I would just like to make a comment that I think this is a good first step, changing some of the bylaws, and I'll be supportive of that, but I also look forward to doing more in the future, because I feel like I feel fairly confident that there's some other bad news coming. But like I said, I feel like this is a good first step.
The motion by Commissioner Frost, is there a second? Second by the chair. Any further discussion? Any further comments? All those in favor of the bylaws as presented, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. The bylaws amendments are adopted by 7-0 vote. Next, we have Ridgeview Farm Amendment.
We have two amendments related to that. The first one, and I'm sorry I didn't catch this and bring it forward earlier, it was not a majority vote when we voted to do the conservation easement, so I wanted to pull the budget amendment up to give you an opportunity to choose how you wanted to vote. $37,500 for a conservation easement at Ridgeview Farms. This is to appropriate the money in the general fund, the first budget amendment is. So it's to appropriate it out of fund balance and move it to a transfer, so we can move it to another fund. So that's the budget amendment before you
move. And a motion and second. Is there any discussion or comment?
I just want to say one of the reasons this was pulled up is because it was combined with something else, and that and I had voted against this originally. Mm-hmm. And so that's why one of the reasons I think that we brought it up is so that we bring clarification to that, I guess.
It was combined with the JCPC ordinance, but this address is just the 37.5 conservation easement.
Okay, any further discussion or comment? All those in favor of the budget amendment, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no.
Okay. So, I meant to say no. My apologies.
Okay, let's vote again.
Sorry.
It starts late. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no.
No.
The motion passes 4-3. Commissioner Frost, Vice Chair Newman, Chairman Jones, 4. Commissioner Belcher, DeBrule, and Fryer against. All right, next we have special project ordinance. It was brought up from consent agenda.
This is also the same project, the Ridgeview Farm conservation easement. What you did in the general fund just now was transfer that money to Fund 24. Now we have to appropriate it to be able to make the payment in Fund 24. So this is appropriating it to spend and recognizing the revenue coming from the general fund.
Okay. There's been a motion by Vice Chair Newman, second by Commissioner Frost. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, I'll call the question. All those in favor of the special project ordinance amendment, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no.
No.
4-3, Commissioner Frost, Vice Chair Newman, Chairman, and Jones, 4. Commissioner Belcher, DeBrule, and Fryer against. Next, we have board appointments. We have Adult Care Community Advisory Board. We have 3 vacancies.
Move Laura Culp.
Ms. Culp has been nominated. All those in favor of Ms. Culp, say aye.
Aye.
She is appointed by 7-0 vote. Nursing Home Community Advisory Board, 2 vacancies. Ms. Kenya and Mr. Henry have been nominated. Any other nominations? All those in favor of those individuals, say aye.
Aye.
They are appointed by 7-0 vote. Nothing has changed since earlier tonight when we did the closed session, I take it. Is that right? Okay. The announcements are January 18, the county offices were closed for Martin Luther King Jr. holiday. January 19 and 8:30, the commissioners will hold a planning retreat in the first floor conference room at 200 College Street in downtown Asheville. In February 2 at 4:30, we will have our next regularly scheduled meeting of the board, also at 200 College Street, room 326. Is there a motion to adjourn?
To move.
Motion by Commissioner Jones. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Frost. Any discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned 7-0.